Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the co-optional podcast for the 9th of February 2016. I'm back from the boat. It's
Yay!
The exact same thing that I said 2 years ago at this exact same time. I am back from the boat. I wish I wasn't.
Did the thing.
I mean, I missed you guys, but the fucking boat was legit, man. What a boat. What a fucking boat. I don't even understand how something that big moves. It's confusing to me. It's insane.
The last time I was on a cruise, and the only time I was on a cruise, was when I was 13 years old. And I've wondered if the experience would be very different as an adult.
Like,
yes.
They're supposedly a lot larger than they look, right? When I see like cruise lines, it's like, oh yeah, it's a nice boat. But apparently
they're fucking huge. Nasty.
They're insane. In fucking sane. We were on the Independence of the Seas, which is not the biggest boat in the world anymore, but it's really fucking close to being the biggest
anymore.
Boat.
So like, yeah,
it's like it's still huge. You know, it's 14 decks. It has just an insane amount of stuff, like multiple restaurants. It has a full size climbing wall on the back of the boat. It has
what?
A surf simulator. It has multiple pools, huge amounts of pools. Like massive amounts, a running track, a solarium, full size gym, which literally nobody used on this cruise. It's like, fuck it, we're metalheads, we don't use the gym. What the fuck are you even talking about? But it had this full size promenade down the middle of the ship, which was just like a kind of a shopping mall area. It was like 3 or 4 or 5 stories high, and there was a pub there and places to eat and all that kind of thing. But the best thing, of course, was the fact that it had proper stages and places to see the bands.
Great.
So that in itself was amazing. Big fan of that. They had an open air stage. They had 2 big stages in the kind of 2 big theaters. And then they had multiple stages in the bars. There's a bar about every 3 feet, which I think is reasonable.
That sounds right. Yeah.
I mean, you know, otherwise there would be a very big risk, very big risk that you would not actually be able to get a drink right when you want it. So I was a big fan of the ship. It was great.
Yeah, you got to mention the mixing and the subbing in and all that stuff that happened.
Yeah,
fans, because that's like the best part.
Yeah, so they do something called the All Star Jam at Sea, and what that is 90 minutes of they play like famous metal covers and they sub in random people from random bands to do it. So we had some amazing covers of stuff like AC/DC, Metallica, Iron Maiden, Motorhead. We had a Motorhead tribute because, of course, Lemmy recently passed away, unfortunately. And the lead singer on that was Christina from Lacuna Coil. And you might think, well, would a female vocalist do Motorhead really well? Because, you know, he's got that growl to him and everything. You know, Lemmy had that very one-of-a-kind
voice.
Oh, it's
the right voice. Lady?
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, she sounded amazing. She nailed it. Completely nailed it. And the last 2 tracks, we randomly had Dave Lombardo, ex-Slayer drummer, on drums playing shit like AC/DC, which was incredible. So, I loved it. The ship also had Wi-Fi, which I deliberately elected not to sign up for. I had 4 days of no
temptation.
Internet. Yeah.
Temptation.
Hey, I read 3 books. 3 entire books. I played and finished 1 game and went well into another game. And I listened to an audiobook and loads of music. And it's like, wow, this is amazing. I get so much more done without the internet. I need to do this more often.
What shock.
Yeah, indeed. But this episode of the Cautional Podcast is proudly sponsored by Crunchyroll.com/TotalBiscuit for unlimited anime at 1080p. Go and sign up for your free trial today, Crunchyroll.com/TotalBiscuit. One thing I did not get a chance to watch on the cruise was much anime because, of course, no internet. But I bet you have, because you have nothing better to do with your life. So
it's true.
What's good on Crunchyroll right now?
So actually, there's an OVA. It's kind of like a one-shot of a manhwa, which is a Korean manga, called Noblesse, and it's been out for a while. And the OVA just released. It's called Noblesse Awakening. And Sam and I watched it together, and I really liked it. As somebody who's read the manga, or the manhwa, I thought that they condensed a lot in a pretty good way. Sometimes OVAs, the pacing on them is really all over the place, and this one, the pacing was pretty good. But what I'm excited for is that it kind of opens the door for them to maybe make anime of more manhwa, and there's lots of really, really good manhwa out there. So,
So what exactly is the plot of this thing? What is it exactly?
So Noblesse is about, it sort of takes the lore of a Dracula figure and changes it a bit. So the idea is that the people that we know of in the past as nobles were people who had special abilities. And there was one noble who was so powerful he could command all other nobles, and he's known as the noblesse. But he's been missing.
Or Sauron, by the sounds of it.
Or Sauron.
One ring to rule them all and all that.
But he's been missing for like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years, and then the story starts when they find his coffin.
Okay.
It's cool.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can go check that out on controller.com/TotalBiscuit, free trial, 1080p, lots of anime, lots of good stuff to watch. You know, worst comes to worst, it has Log Horizon, and that's totally worth watching. So,
true. Go so everybody hold out for a breaker anime. One day, Monroe
lovers. I don't know
lovers.
What that is, but...
It's great.
Fair enough. Our special guest today, I think the last time you were on the show was probably 4 years ago, and we're still called the TGS Podcast. TGS number 7? Yeah. I believe you were under the name Zam Official at that point when you worked for them. Now you are... a much greater being in and of yourself. You have gained power for yourself, and your channel is, of course, called akaMikeB. You're also known as Fony. Welcome to the show. Welcome back.
Thank you so much. Yeah, two months shy of 4 years. I just looked it up. It was like April something, 2012.
Yep.
Man, holy shit.
I can't believe we've been doing the show for that long, but apparently we have. You know, you were one of the originals. You know, you were in the first 2 months of episodes when we didn't think this show would last... You know, 6 months, but there you go.
Yeah, exactly. It was like, yeah, it's just a podcast. Let's just do a podcast. It's fine. Yeah, thanks for having me back, though.
Yeah, of course.
I look forward to coming back again, of course, in 2020.
Yeah, we'll bring you back then. I'll schedule you in for 2020, absolutely. Okay. You know, we won't even have podcasts anymore. We'll be beaming directly into your mind.
Apparently, I need that much heads up in order to actually get a locked-in slot, I think.
Yeah, I mean, I actually scheduled you 3 years ago, but you were that busy. So, you know, eventually something came up in your schedule. It's like, yeah, I've got 3 hours to kill. Why not?
Yeah, exactly.
Now, if people don't know what you do these days, especially considering you have not been around for a long time on this show, what are you doing at the moment on YouTube?
So I'm doing kind of a mix of things. I no longer work for Zam, and so it's opened me up to be able to go back to doing, you know, gaming content. So kind of easing back into that.
Yep.
Also took up streaming a little bit, and, working on music, doing my photography stuff. So basically just like kind of doing a little bit of everything, which is nice to have that freedom and time.
It
to
is, isn't it?
That.
So good.
If, you're on the internet and you're watching right now, what you should be most concerned about is that he has the best job in the world, which is, as far as I can tell, taking pictures of half-naked women all the time. That's literally all
classy,
I see.
Classy pictures. Classy
That's
pictures.
Literally all I see him tweet anymore. And here's the thing. Super jealous. Super jealous.
Yeah.
I'm just saying.
It is. Yeah, it is NSFW model photography.
Yep.
It is very artful.
Indeed.
And yeah, it's great. Thank you for the seal of approval, Jesse.
Love it. Big fan.
I was gonna say they are good photos. Good photos. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Indeed. Well, there you go. So that's what he does. If you wanted to be jealous, I mean, we've had a couple of guests over the last few weeks that people have been jealous of. One being, of course, Xavier Woods, who's like, you know, you are an overachieving son of a bitch. It's just not fair. And now we have you, you know, who is also a lucky bastard. But there you go.
I appreciate it. Yeah.
So Jenna has just walked in. So just before we went on the cruise, I got a little email from You Flowers, who I need to get sponsorship from them, who is like, hey, you've got a credit to spend. Yeah, so like, oh, it's just a flower ordering site. So like, oh yeah, I haven't ordered Jen flowers in a while. So I let her pick the bouquet that she wanted. But what she didn't realize is that...
buy yourself some flowers.
No, no, I paid for it, goddammit.
I got a coupon.
What I did not mention to her is that they now let you do custom vases. She's now walked into the room with a interesting look on her face because I may or may not have made this vase right here.
What the hell is that?
Wait, was that?
It's Cherno Alpha. It's a photo of my Cherno Alpha figurine. She's standing there with a disapproving look on her face.
You're the worst.
Apparently she likes the flowers, though. Yes? Good.
I chose them.
Excellent. So I got it right then.
It's good. It represents both of you guys.
There you go. So I got it right. It's good. Don't. Oh, no.
Oh,
no.
Oh,
ow. Stop. You're not going to hit me with them.
Aw. Oh,
So romantic, shove them in your face.
It is a romantic gesture. You know, the pilots of that mech, they were both, they were husband and wife, and they
and
drowned
they
together.
They were brutalized they drowned and murdered together. By sea monsters, yes. Yes, so romantic.
Jen has a very worried look in her face
we
and is rapidly...
We just got back from a cruise. You want to talk about drowning together?
Well, I mean, that's why I got you the flowers after the cruise and not before, because
yeah,
I thought it might worry
like,
you.
After the cruise is good.
Yeah.
Should we die on this cruise, I hope we drown together. That's all the flowers should have said. That's it.
There you go. So, welcome to the Co-Optional Podcast. We do occasionally talk about video games. Coming up on the show, we'll be talking about the games that we've been playing this week. We'll then play you another Crunchyroll ad, just because we really would like you to sign up, because I really like money, and Crunchyroll gives us a lot of it, so that would be cool. All these guys get money, too. Fony doesn't. He's a guest, but...
Yeah.
We pay him in exposure, you know, which,
yeah!
According to the oatmeal, cannot buy you a hot dog, I'm afraid, but... Yeah. But we do like money. There's no doubt about that. Can I start by talking about a book about a game? Is that okay? Ready Player One.
Yes.
So I read the whole thing.
Currently in production to be a movie.
Yes, which should hopefully be a lot of fun if they execute it correctly. I did start listening to it on an audiobook, but I decided, actually, I think I prefer to read this, because, no offense, but I'm not the biggest fan of Will Wheaton's narrating voice. So I decided, you know what, I'm going to read Ready Player One. That book's fun, definitely. It is a giant geek self-insert fan fiction. I mean, basically the entire moral of the book is, if you know enough about 80s video games and waste your entire life, you can own the world. Which, to be fair, I relate to, because that is exactly what happened to me. By knowing a bunch of bullshit, pretty much actually everyone on the show can actually relate to that in some respect, you know? Mm-hmm. We made a career about knowing too much about video games. So, yep. I can definitely relate to it. It was definitely fun, no doubt about that. It certainly was not the best book I've ever read, but it definitely shoved maybe too many references in it. But it did have some really cool kind of in-depth description of some really old games that I didn't quite know. Like, it told me about the Easter egg in Adventure, which was really awesome. It told me about a game called Black Tiger, and then the Japanese version was actually called Black Dragon and stuff like that, and it explained how the game worked and also interpreted the mechanics in a way that the story would actually work. So a quick overview of what the story is actually about. In the future, world's gone to shit, but we have what's called the Oasis, which is a virtual... They started off as an MMO, but it basically became like everyone's entire life. It expanded to be a social network, and it replaced Facebook and Twitter and everything, kind of in a virtual environment where you wear a headset and haptic gloves to interact with it. And the creator, who is a reclusive, autistic, kind of Steve Jobs kind of guy, dies suddenly. And in his will, he says, I'm going to leave the entire company, which is valued at about $160 billion, and the future of the game to whoever finds my Easter egg. And this guy was a huge nerd for 80s shit. So everything is about 80s stuff. So 80s video games, 80s television, 80s music, etc., etc., etc. And the people who are trying to find this egg are called Gunters. Like egg hunters, just short for egg hunters.
Okay.
No, I know, it's a bit of a dodgy name. Maybe could have picked something a little bit less...
I was imagining like the name Gunter.
No, nothing German related about it whatsoever.
Touch my trauma.
And all these guys are basically, they all research 80s stuff to try and figure out the riddle to get to the next part of the Easter egg and to actually get control of it. And of course, there's an evil corporation trying to take control and all that shit.
Of course, you know.
But it's fun. You know, I definitely see why it got a lot of hype around it. It's definitely not the best written book ever. It's certainly a bit fanficky in many places, but it has enough cool references, and I like the plot. And I love media that's set inside the rules of a game. That's why I think Log Horizon is a really fucking cool anime. And that's why Sword Art Online isn't, because it doesn't respect its own rules. This kind of respects its rules. So it's like, oh, well, they meet a guy and they're in a non-PvP zone, so they can't do anything, but it's like, oh, is there a way that I can delay this guy in this non-PvP zone by using an ability or whatever and, you know, creating a barrier and some shit?
You
can't. It's pretty cool. You actually can, but...
In MMOs, you can't.
No, in most MMOs, you cannot, but in this one, you can a bit, so...
Definitely can't.
Yeah. But Yeah, so I thought it was pretty fun, actually. It was a pretty fun little book. I personally read it. I wouldn't necessarily listen to it unless you're a big fan of Will Wheaton's voice, which, you know, I like him in some of the stuff he does, but I don't think he's the best narrator. What I did discover is that, you know, the guy who does Darkest Dungeons narration?
Yeah.
He is an audiobook narrator.
Oh, shit.
Guess which books he narrated? A bunch of
Lovecraft stuff.
Yes, exactly.
Yes! Wow.
Bunch
That's
of
awesome!
Lovecraft stuff. Wow. So, yeah, you could actually go. What's his name? I want to plug him because he's amazing. His name, I believe, is. I think it's Wayne June. Is his name? I'm just going to double check this on the wiki. Yep. Well, Wayne June. And he narrates a bunch of Lovecraft stuff for audiobooks. So, there you go. If you want to go check that out, then by all means. If Audible, if you'd like to sponsor us, please.
Look, I use Audible more than a human being should.
I use quite a lot of Audible, but we're not going to talk any more about it because we'd really like your money. So, let's, there's a book about a video game.
Jesse Dodger, have you guys read this book?
I own it and have never read it.
I own it too, never read it. It came in a loot crate. It's sitting on a shelf somewhere.
Yeah, I think I got mine in Loot Crate, too. Yeah. So many people have said it's good, and I just haven't touched it yet.
It is.
Yeah, my wife read it, and she's like, you have to read this. You would totally love it. Yeah, it's all gamer stuff, whatever. And I'm like, okay, she's had it right here. It was right here within reach for like 2 months.
It's gone.
And finally she's like, you're never going to read this thing. I was like, no, because they just announced the movie, so I don't have to read anything.
It's a really easy read. Like, I read the whole thing in a day and a half. Like, it was not a difficult read at all. There's nothing complicated about it. If you're into, like, gamer stuff, you'll easily understand everything. So, you can blitz it. I'd recommend it, because I think the movie will be a cooler experience when you've read the book. Because, you know, it's always nice, I think, to contrast what you see in your mind with what you then see on the screen and then get really mad that it's not the same afterwards.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, the book was better. I can't wait.
Yeah. Yeah, it was like me and Watchmen. Although I'm one of the few people that will actually defend the Watchmen movie as actually not being too bad. I don't think there was any right way they could have done it, you know?
I totally agree. That's why everybody...
They should never have done it in the first place.
Yeah, that's what... God. Anyways.
I think they should have gone with the giant octopus squid monster at the end. That would have been
awesome. I agree.
Awesome.
I also agree with that. Change the ending. Why would you change the
Well, I think they should have changed the ending because again, the squid monster would have probably looked pretty shitty on film. You know, I think the ending was a good ending for the movie.
And I have no conflicts like that because I just don't read the books. When I go see a movie, I'm like, this movie's amazing. There's nothing that could contradict this at all because I've not experienced anything like it before. I'm done.
Yeah, I just don't think they could have made a really, really good adaptation of it. I think that it was about as good as it could have been. So I was all right with it. And honestly, like, Rorschach fucking stole the show in that movie.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Incredible acting.
I don't know. I think that big blue dick stole the show.
That was a giant blue penis. I mean,
that was a big blue penis.
If I had one criticism, it was that terrible fucking sex scene in the ship with the fucking...
It goes on forever!
Awkward!
I disagree. It was so awkward.
Singing hallelujah! And then towards the climax, the fucking flamethrower's fire. Like, no, yes. No, the imagery is too on the nose.
Nope. Perfect.
Oh, God.
We can get that.
I didn't hate it, though.
Why can't we have a giant squid beast? That's all I'm saying.
I mean, you do have a pretty reasonable point there, actually. I will give you that. So I have another rant, if you'd like to hear it.
Really?
I watched my first ever game of American football.
Oh, my God. Man. Sam was reading me your Facebook post. He was so happy. Continue.
So,
do it.
Obviously, the Carolina Panthers made it to the Super Bowl and then lost horribly. So our entire state is, of course, in a state of mourning at the moment. And my wife was big into it. And it was she went down to the bar on the boat, but apparently, like, which is really annoying because I'll tell you this, like, metalheads are the best fucking crowd ever. They're super chill. But apparently, if you're a sports fan and a metalhead, you're a piece of shit. Because the Broncos fans that were in the bar were being assholes. Like, complete assholes. Which was really weird, because no one else on the boat at any point was like that. But apparently sports turns you into a fucking asshole.
Yeah.
So... She just came back to the cabin and watched it there. And I was, she was explaining the rules to me. And I came to this sort of slow realization. Americans are a bunch of fucking nerds. Like, real fucking nerds. American football is the nerdiest fucking sport I have ever watched in my life.
Yes,
your national sport is a turn-based strategy game with pseudo real-time non-lethal combat.
Yes.
That requires four GMs to properly enforce and explain the rules, has more stats than advanced D&D, and apparently it's free to watch, but pay to win, and you roll ads in the middle of the gameplay. Like, every 2 minutes, there's fucking ads. I come back, and it's in the middle of a fucking play. I'm like, why do you like this?
You did pick the Super Bowl. Of all games, the one that every year plays a million ads.
Yeah, I mean, you know what's worse is the ads were for ESPN's own shit. Like, it was just watch cricket, watch football, watch the tennis, watch the Masters, over and over and over again. Like, this American football is nerdier than Blood Bowl, and Blood Bowl has fucking goblins in it. Like, if Americans don't realize that they're the biggest fucking nerds on the planet for liking American football, then they are crazy. Like,
has anybody explained fantasy football to you?
Yes.
Because I feel like that's the mod that really takes it to another level.
Yeah, that's a mod for a game that just, because American football wasn't nerdy enough, let's make it even fucking nerdier by going completely overboard on the stats. And then we create fantasy football, which again is D&D for jocks. The whole thing is insane. Like, there's no pace to it whatsoever. They move 2 inches and then stop and then debate for a while. And then the GM, who is the referee, tells you what the next part of the show is going to be. And then they start again and they keep doing it. And it's full of arbitrary, ridiculous rules that nobody seems to understand, which is why they need
change.
An entire commentary team. They change a lot. They need an entire commentary team to explain it.
Jesse's preparing a rebuttal.
It has a shitty physics engine. I mean, whenever they drop the ball, it takes them about a minute to figure out what happened. So it's got the slowest physics engine in the universe. The turnover time is longer than fucking unpatched Civ 5. It is the nerdiest game I've ever seen in my life. And the weird thing is that none of them realize it. You're all a bunch of fucking nerds. Incredible. And this comes from a person whose job it is to critique games with kobolds in them. You're a bunch of fucking nerds.
Jesse, you're winding up here.
Nothing. I strongly disagree. That was the stupidest fucking thing I've ever heard in my entire life. But thanks for doing it. I'm not even going to tell you why you're wrong. You're just wrong. I'll let the internet do it for me. The internet will do it for me. I don't even need to
I don't care. I don't read that shit anymore. That's fine. All you like.
That's true.
You can yell at the void. Yell at the fucking void. Wrestling's less nerdy than this shit. At least wrestling realizes it's silly.
It is. I mean, it is. I mean, once you break it down to stats and everything, it is pretty damn nerdy. My brother-in-law is like heavy into it, and it's like it's.
Fight,
I mean,
Jesse's
trying. He's trying.
Crunching numbers, and then there's a probability of, okay, this person, this is their stats, is what they usually do, and so you have a certain expectation of how they're going to perform on the field, right? And that's kind of how you have, like, in a role-playing game,
that's
like, you have certain
sport.
Stats.
What the fuck are you
No, it isn't
about?
At all.
No,
yes,
but it's,
it is.
It's,
most sports are played in real time and don't stop every 2 seconds.
Play on the field? Oh my god, you guys are
No.
Have you ever watched another sport?
Wait, he brought up turn-based, right? Like, a little bit
Which
of real time,
is.
Right? Like, that adds the extra layer, right? When you play basketball or soccer, like, there's a lot of – football, I guess. There's a
you
lot of
– soccer.
Right,
I'm
right.
in football.
The game is, like, constantly moving. So you're just – you have a constant – that you're not, like, stopping and resetting and getting in a different position in order to actually
Every
do another
Every single
attack.
Fucking time, yeah.
You're basically constantly moving, and the game's constantly revolving. In football, you're constantly resetting the game board, and you're just you're coming with a different defense, a different attack strategy – every other minute.
Yes.
So that's the extra layer. You're right. Yeah. Like, the stats apply to every sport. They totally do. But the extra layer of the turn-based stuff, like, it applies. I think it applies.
Yeah, I mean, I think it would be better if they had, like, a chance to hit on screen. It's like, the guy throws, like, 68% chance to hit. And it's like, miss! Or, like, show, like, a D20 being rolled. I think you could do that if you wouldn't get sued out of existence by the NFL for doing it. I'd love to take the Super Bowl and just add those little elements in an edit afterwards, like D20 roll, misses target, like critical miss, fumble, you know, injury, and all. Roll on an injury table, you know, whenever, I mean, really, it is a game about taking a wholly powerful artifact, which is the egg of the king, as those who watch Berserk will know, and taking it to the opponent's end zone in order to break down their force field, and then, you know, to attack them through what they call the goal, and then you get points, you know, and you level up, basically. It's a giant, nerdy, fucking turn-based strategy game. Incredible, really. And apparently you guys all love it.
You know,
I don't even know how it's played.
I don't know where
you
watch it.
I kind of understand it now. I kind of get it. I mean, actually, I don't get it.
You don't get it. I'm on a show with a man who doesn't get it, a girl who doesn't watch it, and Mike B is too busy looking at titties. You guys are the worst. You're the worst. I hate all of you.
Which is awesome, but since you've not provided any sort of defense whatsoever, then...
If I ever gave a shit to go out and watch soccer and learn all the stupid shit in that besides men running up and down the field...
There's very little stupid shit. Literally the only stupid shit in soccer or football, as it's known in the civilized world, is the offside rule. That is the only...
I don't even know what that is.
No, most people don't. That's literally the only stupid thing about it. Everything else is completely logical.
I just fundamentally... Oh my god. Oh my god. Internet... Just do it for me. I can't even be asked.
Yep, he's too lazy because he can't rebut. Because he knows my argument's too good. I don't blame him.
No, your argument's stupid. I wouldn't want to go out either. Your argument's stupid. It's so dumb, it's not worth our time. Let's move on. Oh, my God.
No, hold on, though. You mentioned that you were watching it and you saw – you obviously didn't see the commercials.
You saw it on ESPN, which means he probably wasn't even watching the game. He probably watched, like, an ESPN classic game from 1952. He's like, I guess –
I'm fairly sure they didn't have drones in 1952.
Like, I'm just saying the game wasn't on ESPN. I'm just saying.
Well, you missed out on the commercials.
Yeah,
that's really the main reason to watch the Super Bowl.
Yes, I do find it amusing that America worships ads to the point where they literally tune into a show to watch them. That's, I mean, I do kind of understand it to a lesser degree because people tune in for our Squarespace ads, but this is on a whole other level than that.
It's because there's people that want to tune in for the game, right? And the people that have to go with those people that want to watch the game,
yeah.
They need something, and so that's the ads.
Yeah, that and the halftime show, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
This is why esports will never make it big on TV here. Oh my god.
That's fine. Oh, TV's dying anyway. The only thing keeping it alive is fucking ESPN. Fucking Food Network, maybe.
I was so sad. Okay, so there was an ad. We were on one of those planes that just showed straight up cable TV.
Mm-hmm.
And I had the Food Network on. And it was like, get the Food Network app. And now you can watch live Food Network TV on the app. And I was like, literally like grabbed Sam like, oh my god, my life is forever changed. Mm-hmm. And he goes, you realize that's going to be a subscription, right? Like that's
not.
You don't just get the app and watch it. It's not?
No. I think you get ads, but yeah, you can actually watch like almost all of Chopped on there. Like, because I'm rapidly running out of Chopped episodes on Netflix. I'm like, oh shit. Fuck, is there some way I can get the Food Network on demand? And there's not. Like, Hulu doesn't have it. Netflix doesn't have it. Amazon doesn't have it. Netflix only has
grocery games for free all day long.
Yeah, I believe so. But if you actually get the app, then yeah, you can watch a lot of VODs and live Food Network. I believe they just run ads on it. So, which is kind of annoying because obviously that's a lot of ads, but I don't know how many ads they run, though. Like, I don't know if it's as bad as the live shows, so... Yeah, you can get the Food Network app. You don't need a subscription. I actually prefer if they did because I would pay just for the Food Network.
If there was a Food Network app where I didn't need to pay and an HGTV app where I didn't need to pay, that's literally HGTV. All I have ever used.
What is that?
HGTV. It's where all of the house shows are.
Yeah.
It's
like a Canadian network. It's got Homes on Homes, man. Mike Holmes.
Yeah.
And it's got Chip and Joanna.
That's the file we always wanted.
Chip and Joanna fixing up houses in Texas with their five kids. They're so cute. I can't. I love HGTV.
All right, Jesse. Now, why do you not like HGTV?
Because it's stupid. Yes. I don't even need to rebut it. Internet, rebut home improvement TV for me. All right, all right, all right.
Do you not watch at all? I mean, it's some good shows, man.
Jesse, what do you want to talk about?
Yeah, what would you like to discuss, Jesse?
Video games.
Oh.
By all means.
Right. Did you hear that there's a lot of video games coming out this week?
They're all really good. Mm-hmm. Well, you could get in the beta of Overwatch if you wanted to.
Should we start with Overwatch?
Or maybe you could play some other games. I hear Oxenfree is good. Firewatch came out today. Maybe you can play Unravel. That sounds like fun. You can play with that little yarn guy. That would be great, right?
I love right, after everybody? 5 years of derailing the show, Jesse is now the one mad that we've derailed the show. It's come full circle.
The biggest face I've also ever seen Jesse make, by the way.
I can't let's talk about video games.
Overwatch!
So great.
We're going to do it. Go. Now the one guy in the subreddit can get mad again. We're back on Overwatch. I can't
it's
wait.
Overwatch!
Overwatch! The next hour of the show will be about Overwatch.
I haven't had a chance to play it yet. Tell me everything that you have said this morning. I need to know.
I've only played two games since, because they just brought the beta back up. Right.
So you've learned nothing.
No, I have. I've learned some things. So they made some improvements. The most obvious big change to Overwatch is that it now has a progression system. But what they mean by that is you have an infinite level cap, and every time you level up, you get a box. In the box, there are four items. Those items are cosmetic. So they can include skins for your character, skins for your weapons, new voice lines for your character, that's new crazy. Taunts. There's apparently one you can get animations for the...
Have you not looked at the bonus shit? TB! Have you not looked at the bonus shit?
What bonus shit?
Oh my god. So, when you first log in, I'm not saying I'm making a whole video of this, but I'm doing it because fuck it, I want the money. There is legit, like, an entire section where you can log into the game now and see all the stuff you can unlock for each character. Everything from the tags you can get to the lines of dialogue you can unlock, to the different skins you can get now, and there's multiple skins for everyone. Some of them are the pre-order ones. Some are like May in a fireman's outfit. Or
yep. I have a legendary skin. The first drop I got was legendary skin, I think, for Reinhardt.
Yep,
so it's a Black Knight skin, and his axe, his hammer is now a fucking battle axe.
Yes,
it's metal as
like
fuck.
That's the evil version
evil
of him.
Evil Reinhardt, yeah, I have that.
There's one where he doesn't have his mask on, and he's in, like, his old armor, and he looks, like, grizzled as shit.
Yep.
There's, oh my god, there's
the
one
skins
where
for weapons.
Mariachi Reaper?
Yes, is Mariachi Reaper is great.
Oh, that sounds like fun.
He has a guitar on his back that has, like, the skull on it and stuff. There is a, holy shit, there's a, Symmetra has one that is her as, I'm trying to think of what god it is. Not Kali. It's some god. And she's blue and looks badass. Mm-hmm. There's so much shit.
Yeah,
really good.
You can also get some like cool unique skins for weapons and abilities. So I got a skin for what the fuck's Roadhog, yeah. Which his ultimate now fires popcorn. It's a popcorn gun. incidentally, people are like, did you buy it? You can't buy anything in the beta. People right. seem to not understand that. They put out an update a couple of hours ago, and there was also an interview on PC Gamer where they were talking about whether or not they would let you buy those boxes with real money, and they said they haven't decided yet, but currently in the beta, no, there's no way to buy that shit.
But
I like that.
It definitely when you go to like the box unlocks thing, it says like shop?
Yeah.
So there's definitely, it's there, but
yeah,
not
so what they're doing is there's a credit system in the game. You can salvage items you don't want for in-game credits, and then you can spend the in-game credits to get the specific thing that you want. So that's how it works.
It's like dust.
Yeah, it's exactly like dust. So they probably will, but ultimately, like, I'm totally fine with them charging for that because it's cosmetic shit. Why the fuck would I not be okay with that? You know?
That's so totally some other ones that are awesome, by the way. First, you have a ridiculous, like, who is this? Hanzo has, like, a wolf, like, an akami skin, which is great.
Aww.
Junkrat has a skin that's literally just him after he exploded in his face, so he's all charred and burnt, which is great. He has a jailbird costume, so he's in his, like, crazy outfits. But anyway, the best part about it is you can unlock, you know when you win a match? Or not win a match, but like you're ranked, like they give you the cutscene at the end where it shows your character do something awesome, right?
Yeah.
Like play of the game. You can unlock and change the thing your character does before it shows play of the game. And some of them are genuinely really funny. There's one where Junkrat shoots his gun off It hits the screen, bounces back, and hits him in the nuts, and he falls over, and that's like his like Junkrat play of the game.
That's what I want. I need
there's
it.
There's one where May goes to like launch herself off with her like ice cannon, and it fires and creates a wall, and she shoots up in the air and ends up on top of the wall, and her glasses like tilt over. Oh my god. There's one where I think it's Soldier 76 like shoots through the screen, like the actual like, you know, he's shooting through your computer screen. There's so much cool stuff that they've added to this game. It's super.
They've
dope
gone
now.
Full TF2 with the cosmetics. Yeah. And that's exactly what they should have done. Exactly what they should have done. And hopefully that will be enough to monetize the game without having to resort to anything bullshitty. So I like it. There's also some minor improvements. They seem to have widened the field of view, and they've also told you what the field of view actually is. So I think the maximum right now is 105, which is good. That's good. Nice. I think they've also shrunk some of the weapon models. Like, the view models are a bit smaller, from what I can tell. So that was cool. They changed the in-game... they changed the fucking opening menu theme, the music. I don't like the fact that they did that. Yeah.
It's an altered arrangement. Yeah, but it was fine before.
It's an altered arrangement. They do this all the time. Like, they did it with StarCraft a lot, and they did it with... You remember Heroes of the Storm for the Alpha? They kept changing the fucking music.
They change it all the time now, yeah.
Yeah, they've done it this time, too. And I'm like, it's not as good as it used to be. I liked it better earlier.
Do you think it might be like a rotating track, like it's always the same song, but
I don't know,
arrangements?
But based on what they did with Heroes of the Storm, like, they just keep revamping the music, and they're like, oh, we think this arrangement's better. Like, no! The first one was better. Yeah. Certainly for a $40 game right now, it's looking good. I haven't tried the new mode yet. That I have no idea what's going on with that, but I'm glad that they actually put one in, because the biggest weakness of that game is the game modes being boring as shit. So I hope that the new mode is innovative in some way. But I'm glad it's back.
Have you seen any of the tags? Because the tags are actually kind of what I'm most interested in. Like, to be able to leave a mark.
Yeah, there's multiple...
of them.
There's tags that everyone could unlock, and then every character has their own tags as well.
Yeah.
And so, as far as I can tell, there's like little chibi versions of the characters. Sometimes they have their own symbols.
Yeah.
Sometimes they have like own cool things. What I thought was really funny was Mercy has... You know how every once in a while on the sidewalks you see those really like shitty painted wings that people take their like Snapchat photos in front of?
Yeah,
she has those. She just paints like two wings, and then you can stand in front of it and be like, "Take a screenshot."
Aww.
Yeah, like they all have great ones. I think I like that Junkrat and Roadhog have their wanted posters they can stick on the wall.
That's cool. Yeah, nice. I want to look those. I got a Tracer one, and a couple of other things, but. Yeah, every time you level up, you get a box, and there's four things in it. And I think it's like three commons, and then you have a chance for... It's a minimum of an uncommon, and it goes all the way up to legendary. And the legendary skin that I got, I think, was for Reinhardt. So it's perfect. Like, it's exactly what I wanted out of the progression without them fucking it up, you know?
Right. Have either of you tried the new game mode?
Nope. Although I'm told that it is kind of a King of the Hill-esque thing. Someone's saying it's like...
Basin.
So, yeah, someone's saying it's like Homefront or something like that, which is interesting. I'm intrigued. I'll have to try that out. But I didn't get into... My matchmaking put me into attack defense against JP's bullshit fixed team on the easiest defense map in the fucking game. And they still almost lost, I might add.
I think it would be cool if, like, if they made a game mode that sort of threw out the team v team idea and just made it so that it was every man for themselves doing something. That would really, like...
How would that work?
What do you mean?
How would that work, though? Like, it's a very team-orientated game. Like, so it's a point where
I know, but
like...
it's a completely different game mode, right?
True, but there's
having
some...
one game mode where it's just, like, choose whoever you want to be, and then there's, like, an item you have to keep in your possession for a certain amount of time.
Okay,
and you can swap to different characters if you want when you die, but, like, you're trying to... You're, like...
But there's a bunch of characters that are totally useless without... friends, well, like, you'd have to rebalance, like, no one would ever play Mercy, like, if you're on your own, right?
Yeah.
So, you could do custom games now.
You can, yeah, there is a custom game, I don't know how many options you get in it.
Yeah, I don't know if it's the, hero selection limit, one per team, two per team, et cetera. Yeah, I don't know if there's, like, a minimum, like, if it'll fill the rest of the AI or something. Never mind, game custom AI have been improved. Okay, so, it's possible that maybe you could trim it down, just have, like, a 1v1 if you want, but it's gonna be, like, friend versus friend. Do you want something a bit more like 6v free for all or something. Is that what you're looking for?
Yeah, she's saying like everyone goes themselves. For an item, yeah. And it's everyone's.
I just match. Want them to think of something that nobody's going to think of. Like King of the Hill is so blasé to me. I just want them to come up with something where everybody's like, "Oh, that's
fuck
an interesting idea."
I think it still has to be team based though. Like it's just like they've built the whole game around it to the point where half the characters wouldn't even be viable in a free for all mode.
Yeah, so, that's fair.
I mean, I think like yeah. I think what would be cool is a weekly rotation of themes. Like someone suggested in chat, which I think is a great idea. This week, everyone's Tracer, and it's a Tracer free for all. You know, or you know this week. That you know that it's a no support week. You know, there's no support classes at all. Everyone's a tank, or you know, all that kind of thing. That would be neat. And then like give a reward, kind of like a tavern brawl, but in Overwatch. You know, with some weird rule sets. That would be neat. I'm cool with that.
Yeah, something like Hutball or something like that would be good too. Hutball, Deathball, something where you basically have control over something, you have to get it to an end zone.
Yeah, I like that idea, particularly considering that the levels are very much based on like walking through the level. So if you could actually do a push in between a section of that level and have it be like you said, like Hutball or like old school medieval football, where it was just take the pigskin to the other village and don't get killed with a pitchfork. Do that. I'd play that mode. That would be pretty fucking legit. So yeah, I think there's a lot of potential. Like, the improvements look pretty good so far. So we'll see where it goes.
I would love a mode where you had to, like, get a ball or something from one side to the other. As long as whatever the thing you were holding hurt you over time. Because that would drive me crazy to see, like, a Genji with that ball. I'd lose my mind. I'd lose my mind. He's like running up walls and shit. I'd be like, nope, fuck that guy. It would be like one of those things. Like everyone, you have to like keep it moving, keep it like passing it around.
Yeah, like if you stand still for too long, then the timer is gonna go off or something, explode like, or something. Yeah, something to keep you moving, keep the action going.
And I don't want it to be drops, like so if you have the ball, you can't use your abilities because I hate when people do that shit. Like I don't just you know that just means that there's gonna be the one guy who's like, I got it. I don't need abilities. And all they do is just get the tankiest people they had and then just slowly move down like, I'm going down.
Yeah, but, you know, the thing with that is that you can trade speed for durability, you know? So if you get Tracer, it's like, oh, look at how fucking fast I am. I can run with the ball, but I don't have 150 HP versus, you know, doing it with Roadhog. Like, it's viable. I mean, basically, it's Unreal Tournament 2004's bombing run, which, to be fair, if they're going to steal anything, steal bombing run, because that was pretty good. Mm-hmm.
And focus fire is a bitch, so no matter who you put with the ball, you're gonna
they're gonna get
there.
Splattered one way or the other. You know, you've got to properly protect them. So yeah, it's definitely a good mode, I think. But I'm just glad it's back. I missed it. I got right back into it. It runs a bit better now. The frame rate's a lot higher. Seems a bit tighter. So happy about that. And now we can bother everybody.
My video has TotalBiscuit harassing me, guys. So just so you're all aware.
Yes. I mean, you were sitting there and like you declined my party invite, and I was offended. I was
super
really,
harassment.
Really triggered
super
by that.
Super harassment.
Yeah,
I've never been so offended.
Indeed,
you were actually about 15 minutes ago.
Yeah, I mean, he was very offended 15 minutes ago.
I'm.
I mean, it's all the honor of his country. I mean, it's totally fair.
I'm just an offensive person. Just
easily offendable or something, right?
Yeah, man.
An offendatron.
I've been on the internet too long. I have opinions, guys.
Oh, no. Not those. Anything but those. On the internet? Unacceptable. All right, so what else have you been playing this week? Let's go over to Fony. What do you got for us?
Actually, before, while you guys were all apparently playing Overwatch, I was playing Firewatch for a little bit.
Firewatch, yes.
Yeah.
I played 10 minutes of it, got really depressed, and turned it off.
Yeah, I did the same thing.
It's super short, isn't it?
It's like 5 or 6 hours. It's definitely not like Gone Home short. It's longer than that. But the first 10 minutes of the game are really fucking depressing.
Here's the thing, dude. You can't even talk about it. Like, it's one of those things you, like...
Because you'd spoil it.
Spoilers,
right?
Yeah, I want to talk about Firewatch, but I can't even talk about it. Like, it's super spoiled.
Yeah.
And I'm not gonna like this is beyond like finger moment. Like this is just like go play it yourself. That's all I'm gonna say.
If the rest of the dialogue and the story plays out how it has in the first several minutes, then I mean I'm sold. Like it's I was gonna play a little bit before the show, and I was like, I can't play this before the show. I'm gonna go to the show and be like, hey guys, Where's Mike B?
I'm really, really sad.
Yeah.
what was not made clear, I think, in the trailers is just how fucking depressing it is to start with. Yeah. It is.
Yeah. Right. Wasn't that, like, everybody's been writing articles the last couple of days being like, why was Firewatch so secretive before releasing their game? Why didn't they tell us more about it? And it seems like that's pretty obvious, right? Is that they didn't want you to know
obvious from the
what
very
kind
fucking
of a game
start.
It was going to be so that you could just experience it.
Yeah, because in many ways, it's a walking simulator. It does have some interactivity, thank fuck, you know?
Yeah.
But it's definitely got a lot of walking in it. So if you're not a fan of walking slowly... because the game has a lot of walking slowly.
Yeah. I was like hitting shift. I was like, I'm not running. Okay.
That was really annoying initially. I'm like, oh God, is this another DRS though? But for 6 hours, and if it ends up being that, I will hate it. I can guarantee that I will hate it.
Mm-hmm. No, it seems interesting. Prior to that though, I was actually playing American Truck Simulator 2.
Of course,
or not too. Sorry,
as was everybody else, because that game is really good. Like, tell us about it.
So I have a steering. I got it for Dirt Rally. Right? I got a steering wheel and shift and all that stuff. Right, and Dirt Rally is a lot of fun and everything. But I couldn't imagine playing a non-racing game with the wheel and all that stuff. And so I loaded it up. I didn't understand the point. Right, you get in and I put everything on manual. Which of course made it impossible because there's like 27 gears, or it's actually under there. But you're sitting there shifting and then hitting a modifier, shifting again, and then hitting a modifier, shifting again, just to get moving. And then of course there's all the laws and all the stuff are in place. So if you end up exceeding, you get the cops don't pull you over; they just kind of drive by like whoop whoop, and you get like an email, and they're just
you get
fine.
Fines, Joe. Yeah.
You've been pulled over.
Yeah, and that's pretty much it. But it's relaxing once you get into it. It's kind of just like a chill game. And then there's the multiplayer element that these guys modded in, which works beautifully. You just get in. There's no AI. You just basically drive around. There's other truckers, and you're just like, what's up? How's it going? It's weird. It's weirdly fun. I don't understand. Like, you're not racing. You're not, like, e-braking around turns or anything like that. You're just driving a truck.
It's just satisfying to do that. Euro Truck Simulator, this is the same company that made Euro Truck Simulator, by the way, which is why people are excited about it, because Euro Truck Simulator was ludicrously popular, and it's just fun to drive a truck. It's relaxing. Mm-hmm. Like, it really, it's quite, I actually quite enjoyed it. And that's weird for me, because I hate Sims. I have no interest in Sims at all. But American Truck Simulator and Euro Truck Simulator are both really relaxing games.
Uh-oh.
Apparently, Jesse does not agree.
I can't imagine those games being anything other than boring. That's all.
No. The only way, people wanted me to do it for Fan Friday. The only way I could get through it was by blasting the Eastbound Down in the background. Needless to say, YouTube flagged that shit immediately. Don't care. That's the only way I could get through that game, was playing the Smokey and the Bandit music in the background while I drove around. Because it is so effing boring. Oh, my God. I guess if, like, you need a chill game and your life is so crazy, you need, like, the silence of the open road.
It's just something
that's what it is.
It's just something different. That's all it is.
It's one of those things that, to me, takes me back to, like, I want to fly my fantasy ship. I want to be the hero with the sword who fights the dragon. I get even things like, I want to create a weird garden that has, like, plants that don't exist. I don't get, I want to drive. Get in your fucking car and drive.
This isn't
a
car,
though.
This is a truck. This is an 18-wheeler truck. I don't have a truck license.
A truck license.
Then go learn how to swing a sword.
But then you need a truck. You can't get a truck unless you have hundreds of thousands of dollars or work for a trucking company. Like, that's not a thing you can do. Like, if it was Honda Civic Simulator, I'd get your point, but it's not.
I don't get it. I just don't understand.
You know, there's choices, there's an experience system, you earn money, you can set up your own trucking company while you're in the game. You know, it has legitimate elements to it, you know?
Yeah. I get it. I mean, I understand fundamentally that I will never understand the lore of the open road and what it's like to have the wind in your hair as you ride.
So why would you have the wind in your hair in a full carriage? Like, what?
You got your windows down. You got 18 wheels of justice underneath you.
18 wheels of justice.
Going over the American open road. Take it to places you ain't never been, but places you always knew you were from. That, my friend, is what trucking's about.
So it sounds like you do understand it.
I get it. but I just gets don't.
It more
I
than anybody.
Do it.
You get it, but
yeah,
you don't get
so
it.
That's what's so sad. That's what's so sad. I get it, and I've denied. I've denied that that's who I really am.
Oh man,
deep in my soul.
I think I'm going to play the shit out of it when the Oculus Rift comes out, because that is a perfect Rift game.
Yeah, it needs it so bad. Like,
I mean, Eurotruck has Oculus support already. I think this one does too.
I'm sure. It's like there's so many times I want to like stare down people for doing dumb things on the road, just like in real life. And mm-hmm. I have to, in order to do that, I'm like sitting back here at the wheel, and I'm like reaching for my mouse. I'm like, and I, that way I can turn around, look behind me, and say what. And then I have to look forward again, move my mouse, look forward, and then continue driving. Like, I'm not going to make that so much easier.
So, let me pitch something to y'all.
All right.
My dad used to drive a truck way back mm-hmm. in the day. And he said that one of the best parts of driving the truck was that all of the truckers in the area had the same, like, radio station that they would all talk to each other on.
CB.
Can we simulate this? All of us get the Oculus Rift. All of us play this truck game and be on Skype and pretend that we're all just truckers chit-chatting with each other because we got nobody else.
Yeah, I call Smokey as my call.
You could even do convoys. So you guys could actually get together and do convoys. Yeah.
Convoy!
I'm Wild Weasel. Just want to point that out.
Great.
So I'm going to be.
Great. Yep. What are you, Dodger? What's your call sign?
Like,
I think Dodger's already a good trucker call sign, right? It's pretty good.
No.
Oh, maybe you got to add an extra word to it.
Dodger breaks a lot. I don't know.
I wouldn't trust Dodger breaks a lot in my convoy. That's
Dodger. What are those flappy daps in the back on a truck?
Dodger flaps.
Yeah, those flaps that
Dodger
either have like
Dodger
naked
flaps?
Lady silhouettes,
something,
or they just look like balls.
Dodger something flaps. Doesn't quite,
you know,
sound right about that.
Sometimes people put like fake balls in the back of their truck.
Apparently, Krendor is Speedy
Dodger
Sloth.
Balls.
So
I'll
there
be
you
Dodger
go.
Dodger balls.
Dodger balls. Yes. Fony, what's your trucker call sign?
I think it would just be like chin stripe or something. Just
chin stripe.
Yeah, I like it.
Chin stripe, yeah.
Wild Weasel chin stripe over.
Mud flaps, that's the word.
Mud flaps. Dodgy mud flaps.
No. Dodger's name is just Mud Flaps.
Perfect.
Mud flap.
Perfect.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Everybody, how's it going, Mud Flap?
Wild Weasel and Mud Flaps over.
Not even playing along. She doesn't even recognize her own name. We'll get it. We'll fix it. From now on, I'm just calling you Mudflap. Every day, all day.
Mudflap. I'll wear a sign so that when I look in the mirror, I go, that is me.
I'm Mudflap.
I am Mudflap.
You see your vest and your hat? You can just, yep.
Yeah. I'll have a shirt. I'll do
buy
like
you
we
a
used
flannel
to do
shirt.
At the Buckaroo. I'll have a white shirt, and in Sharpie, I'll write Mudflap. But backwards so that when I look in the mirror, I read it.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Couldn't ask for anything
like,
more than that.
She's special.
What else you been playing this week, Fony? Anything?
Stonehearth, actually. Somebody actually gifted me a copy of Stonehearth.
Okay.
And,
tell us about that.
It's funny. Like, looking at the name now, it's like I've actually also been playing a lot more Hearthstone lately because I've been working out. So it's mm-hmm. like, it's Hearthstone. Okay, sure.
Well, yeah, I mean, those two things definitely go together.
Yeah, totally interchangeable. It's kind of like Banished, but but it's more cutesy and voxel based, and you have like Banished. You feel like you have these real people, right?
Yeah, Banished is a misery simulator.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like, but when people die, they usually die in like droves. When they die, one person dies, like yeah, you know what? That person's been around for a couple hours, right? But in this game, it's like everyone's all like cute and everything. They all have their own little personalities, and when they start getting attacked, they're like no, and then blah, they died. Like, oh Jesus, what? Oh God! But it is just like Banished. It's just cute and bright.
You seem like you design your buildings in this. Like,
yeah, and that's the other thing too. You could design your buildings.
It's a bit
you could choose what materials to use for almost each component. So
okay.
Like the columns, support columns, the doors, the walls, all that stuff.
Okay.
But it's I'm like 4 hours in or so. Like the first save, you always just jump because you have no idea what you're doing. You're getting attacked by everything and
course.
You're just dead.
Yeah.
The second save, I got my shit down, and it's I think I'm already at like 5 hours or so. I'm kind of reaching probably like maybe a few more hours, and I'll be kind of topped off in terms of what's available right now to the game.
Mm-hmm.
But
the game's still in early access, right?
Yeah.
OK.
Have you hacked up neat. And had to start over yet?
Yeah, or... just after the, yeah, just your first save. It's just like, you know, you just throw that away in games like this because you're just trying to figure out the mechanics of everything.
Trying to understand it, yeah.
It's almost like Minecraft Manager.
It feels kind of, yeah. Yeah, a little bit. You control all the little Sims or whatever.
Yeah,
they're
all basically playing Minecraft and you're controlling them and telling them where to go.
Mm-hmm.
It's weird. But it's a neat idea. I like the principle of it. I'll probably wait till it's out of early access, though, because... I'm sorry, like, oh, those of us that got burned by Castle Story, we just don't trust this shit anymore. Like, we don't.
Yeah, it's hard. It's hard, because it's like, do I do it now while everyone's talking about it, or do I wait until it's out and nobody's playing it? What's the balance here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Fair enough.
Oh, yeah, Cube World, that was the one that killed it for a
oh,
lot of
God,
people.
Yes.
Yeah, that was like, that's like the king of killing it right there.
Yep, yeah. Definitely. It's definitely on the list.
Apparently,
of...
they're still working on it.
Yeah, sure. Know. Okay, I'll wait for the release in 2025.
Great. That's how I'm feeling.
I'll come back
Everybody's
for that
like,
show.
Did you hear?
I'll come back for that show.
They did an update. They're talking about all the stuff they did. And I'm like, that doesn't excuse the fact that they went dark for like.
Yeah, they
ever.
Went dark for like a year. And the people
like,
that
no,
bought it really early on are fucking idiots. I'm sorry, you are. Like, I know a lot of people jumped on it. It's like. YouTubers in particular are like, this is gonna be the next Minecraft, we're gonna make some fucking money. They, you know, they got the alpha immediately.
It was so much fun, the combat felt so good. Like, you look
and
at
then
it
you realized,
around,
oh shit, where's the rest of the fucking game? And
yeah,
then you
was,
waited
yeah,
and
just...
waited and waited and it never appeared.
Like, if even that, even the base game, the skills and the stats, how you accumulate them, it was so jacked up. Like, you would earn stats at a weird rate, and then, like, weapons would require X amount. It was just, like, all the numbers were just jacked. You couldn't even, like, play what you currently have for more than a few hours without having to basically reset and start over.
Yeah. Yeah, well, ultimately, people might make this claim that's like, oh, well, you know, they made no promises, they had no timeline. Yeah, but I think there's a reasonable expectation, you know? It's like, yeah. You haven't updated the game in 2 fucking years. I think it's reasonable for people to say, huh, maybe this game's been abandoned. You know?
Yeah.
Stop buying early access shit. There's plenty of good real games that are out right now. Go buy them. Jesus. What the hell's wrong with you?
Yeah, there's so many. There's so many that are like a mixed bag. And yeah, it's hard. It's, yeah. Space Engineers. Have you ever played any Space Engineers?
I have not. I have actually been told that's pretty good, though.
So I'm like 1,100 hours in or so.
What?
Yeah, yeah. I'm like 1,100 hours in.
Yeah, I mean, you seem like you're doing reasonably well with that.
Yeah, it's. I mean, it's Minecraft in space, right?
Yes.
Except for you have some engineering elements and everything.
Oh,
and
you can make ships, right?
You can make ships. They added planets, so now you have to fight with gravity and all that. The game is flexible enough that I actually created a budding esports in the game where we actually took Robot Wars and BattleBots and we were doing it inside. We have like these crazy arenas with like moving parts and traps and all that stuff. And we put all this stuff inside. That's how flexible the game is.
That's cool.
It definitely is not without its problems, right? Like stability and everything you'd expect in an alpha game. Where like 1 week, it runs beautifully and it's great. We could do all this stuff. And then the next week, it's like... nothing runs. Everything's exploding. It sucks. But still, like, just the amount of crap you could create in it is just, like, dumb, which is why I have 1,100 hours in the damn thing.
That's an impressive amount of value that you got from, what, a $15 or $20 game?
Yeah, somebody pulled it up, like, on some random Steam site. It was, like, I think it was something like 1.6 cents per hour or something. I got out of this game.
It's a bargain. It's an absolute bargain.
It's a steal right there. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I've heard good things. I mean, I'm not the sort of person that wants to invest a huge amount of time into building some like virtual spaceship or whatever. I don't want to invest my time into that, but I can definitely see why people would like it. And it's also one of the only kind of Minecraft survival-esque games that seems to be mostly content complete, you know? It's got enough content to actually justify the price tag.
Yep, it does.
Which is cool. Let's take a break. When we come back, we've got plenty more games to talk about. I got loads of games to talk about, and hopefully these guys do as well. Well, I guess we'll find out. One way or the other, we're going to shill Crunchyroll for you now. So go sign up. Crunchyroll.com/TotalBiscuit. We want money. And they'll give it to us if you go click that link and go watch some fucking anime. We'll be right back.
Good morning, class. Welcome to Anime 101. Today we'll be learning about some real shit.
So sit down and listen up. You want anime? Peel back your eyelids and cram this in your side hole. Crunchyroll is an online service that gives you anime 24 hours a day. They have every type of anime you've ever wanted in the past, present, and future! Crunchyroll uses a complex algorithm powered by modern technology that predicts what anime you will most love, cherish, and want to be protected on your tombstone after you die from watching too much anime!
Well, they can't do that, but...
They do have Crunchyroll Premium, which lets you watch anime ad-free in eye-explodingly magnificent 1080p! You like that manly anime, right? Watch the manliest anime of all time on Crunchyroll.com! JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, Fist of the North Star, Inferno Cop, My Little Sister Can't Be This Cute, and more! Go to TryCrunchyroll.com for your free 14-day trial! Be there or be dead!
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Crunchyroll Podcast. We are sometimes discussing video games, every now and again.
Yeah.
It's true.
It does happen.
We have Jesse here to kind of lead us back, to kind of get everything together.
Yeah.
I'm trying, brother. I'm trying.
We needed him to get us back on track.
Lord knows, I'm trying.
Because we ruined everything, apparently. Mm. Can I talk about Punch Club?
Sure.
I mean, you
go for it.
Yeah. So I beat it on the boat.
I think you're the only person I know who's beaten that game. Who, like, stuck with it long enough to beat it.
I hate it. It's... I actually got an email from the dev who obviously watched my video. You know, I actually felt guilty about the video that I put together on it because I tore that game to shreds. Like, I think it's a terrible video game. And I have a number of very good reasons for that, and I think my logic is solid, but I still felt bad because, you know, when it's a first-time indie team, putting something together was obviously a labor of love. Tearing it to pieces on the basis of its awful mechanics and design is like, oh. But you got to get over that because that game sucks. And the reason it sucks is that it is a secret clicker. I like to call it secret clickler. Is the way I describe it. It's a secret clickler.
I was hoping there would be a secret Hitler.
There you go. Somewhere. Yeah, it's a secret clickler. So this game purports to be a... Oh, God. I really should... Why is that making noise? That's weird. Huh. I had that muted, and then I just got this giant fucking epic out of nowhere. Wah! I didn't mean to do that. Okay, that's now sorted. Yes, so... The reason this game is boring, as I said, it purports to be a management game with RPG and tycoon elements. What it actually is a clicker, essentially, where you have to grind up your character's stats in one of three areas, strength, agility, and stamina. And then you go into a fight, you pick the moves you will use based on the ones that you've unlocked, and then you watch the fight happen. So the process of acquiring the stats is completely uninvolved because all it involves is just clicking on a piece of gym equipment and watching a bar slowly raise. And the fighting system is completely uninvolved because you just pick your moves and then watch it happen and then lose to RNG and get fucking pissed off. And somehow I managed to endure this entire goddamn game and finish it because I was waiting for it to get good. Like, I was hoping at some point it would kick into gear.
And
it never fucking did. And I feel like I wasted my time. And there's so much missing potential in this game. Like, the fighting system could have been interesting. Training could have had some sort of element to it that actually made it interactive. Maybe a mini game or something like that. So that you could train up and maybe you could have, like, critical successes as a result of doing it well. Maybe you get injured if you fucked up too many times. But it has none of that. You literally... Well, like, yeah. It's almost like... It's actually a lot like Game Dev Tycoon. Which all of us, I believe, did find boring eventually. If I recall, Jesse, you played quite a bit of Game Dev Tycoon, right? You did it for Fan Friday, I think.
Loved Game Dev Tycoon.
You loved it? Really?
I had too much fun with it. Eventually, it's like most games, eventually it just became kind of boring.
Can you honestly say that you loved the mechanics, though? Or were you going by on theme? Like, because the theme in that game is really strong.
All right. True facts. Theme, yes. Mechanics, completely... Like, You need, like, a physics degree to understand what the fuck's going on there. Literally, in order to make some of my games, I had to go online and be like, all right.
You had to go to the wiki.
How the fuck do you do this? Oh, yeah. Yeah. It was impossible to know, because it seemed very arbitrary, because sometimes you might make an amazing game, and sometimes... But, with all that said, even through its complete arbitrariness, I still enjoy it. Like, it was fun to create a game and go through the process, and then get shit on. I don't know.
So, here's the question. If you took the game part away entirely and you rethemed it, and instead what you're making is recipe books, would you find that interesting with the exact same game mechanics?
Recipe books?
Let's say, you are building office supplies.
Okay.
It's Office Supply Tycoon.
Yeah.
With exactly the same game mechanics, would you have still found it fun?
Would it allow me to make my instruction manuals like IKEA instruction manuals? Because if that's the case, I would have had a great time. Like, I call this Bjergenslurg. It's all backwards instruction manual. I would love it. I think I kind of agree with you on this, however. I think Punch Club's biggest problem is its arbitrariness is super penalizing. Like, every day you lose stats.
Oh, it's
for
the
no
worst.
Reason. Like, it doesn't make any sense why you would lose those stats except to prolong the game.
Yes. The whole game is padded. Like, the whole thing. Like, the process of training. And if it was a real management game, you just probably click on the menu, click train strength for X hours, and then it would just give you the result. But in this game, you have to watch it happen really, yeah. really slowly. And because that's completely non-interactive outside of clicking on a different piece of gym equipment when you start to become less efficient on one, that's all it is. And it's a game about timing it so that you get maximum stats before you do your fight or event, so you get the maximum chance of winning it, and then as immediately as the day ticks over, you'll probably lose a level in it. You know, there are some talents you can get that will keep your stats at a certain height, but only if you invest a lot. So I got a talent which let me keep my it starts by letting you keep your stats at four always, yeah. Then 8, and then the maximum I think is 13. But if you want to go higher than that, which really, in my opinion, you should push one of those stats even higher than that just so you can have a good chance of winning the game, you've got to keep training, and you've got to train so consistently. And there's a cap to how far you could get. Like, you just physically cannot spend enough time in the game to get it any higher than that. Yep. And the game is it's a massive waste of time, in my opinion. It really is. It's got a great theme. It's got some really cool pixel art and some fun music. And the rest of the game is fucking dull. The dev actually emailed me saying that somehow I managed to miss part of the main story. If that's true, then how the fuck? Because
well,
I beat
you,
the game.
Well, yeah, did you explore everything? Did you explore all
the
different places?
I explored everything. Like, I did all of the stupid fucking fake Ninja Turtles fights that are hidden in the game. I beat the Ultimate Fight League. And what the dev told me is I should have gone to prison after that. And apparently there's a storyline there for beating the Ultimate Fight League. But I didn't. I beat the Ultimate Fight League and then nothing happened.
Well, all your issues seem to be with mechanics.
Yes, it wouldn't have mattered.
The story wouldn't fix.
Yeah, I mean, the story's terribly written anyway. Like, it's... The dialogue is cringy as shit. Like, it seems like it was written by someone who doesn't even speak English properly, I'm going to be honest. Like, especially when you're interacting with your girlfriend, that's... Oh,
where
God.
Was the game made?
That's a good question. Lazy Bear...
Because maybe the people who wrote the dialogue...
Are not
English.
Yeah, they're actually they're based in Russia, so that explains quite a bit. The writing was not good at all. Outside of the cool little references that you get from time to time to movies and video games, the game, you know, the writing is it's badly written. It's not well delivered. It's not compelling in any way. There's not a single interesting character in the entire game.
So really, in the end, you were upset because. You never felt satisfied. Nothing about the game ever gave you a sense of satisfaction.
Nothing about the core gameplay loop is satisfying, and if the story had been really, really, really good, then maybe it just might have got scraped by, but it wasn't that good either. So, as I said, I hated almost every aspect of it. I think it's a terribly designed video game, and I think that it was a wasted opportunity. They could have done a lot of things differently, and I would have loved the game, but because of the way that they did it, I hated it. It was a giant grind. Like, it's what people mean when they say grind. You know? A pointless, repetitive gameplay loop with barely any payoff that you don't enjoy the process of. That's what a grind is. That's the difference between a grind and just having fun with a repetitive game, is whether or not you enjoy that core gameplay loop. Or whether you're just doing it for the reward at the end. And in this case, you are absolutely doing it for the reward at the end. So, yeah. It's nonsense. I hate it. Don't play it. unless you like that idea of slowly grinding up stats and watching a fight, then don't play it. It's not your game.
Yeah, perhaps on mobile or something, but not on PC. There's a billion other things I could throw on here that would, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I played it entirely on iOS, and like if I played it on PC, I would have hated it even more. So, there you go. Not a fan. All right, who else has got something else? Because I got plenty more, but I'd like to let you guys get in.
So, Sam and I played the app version of Agricola, which is an old board game.
Yeah. It's a board game about
farming. I've never played the board game before. Apparently it has a follow-up game that everybody says is even better, where you're dwarves going out on missions.
What's the name of that game?
I'm trying to remember.
It's not Stone Age. It's something
Agricola,
else.
What would be the word? Agricola.
Cave. Caverna. Caverna. The cave
Caverna,
farmers is what you're looking for.
That's
yeah.
it. Yeah, Sam and I plan on buying Caverna so that we can play it. And he was like, oh, have you not played Agricola? And I was like, no, I've heard of it, but I've never played it before. And so we found out that there's an app version of it. And the tutorial is pretty extensive. It goes on for quite a while. Yeah. Part of the tutorial is specifically for people who've played a lot of the board game and want something to sort of help bridge the gap.
Yes.
So it's like, would you like to skip the whole tutorial and just hear what's different about the app versus the board game? And so there's that if you know how to play the game, but like the UI is confusing to you. But yeah, it's a game. It's a farm building game. So in my mind, it's a deck builder, because like your farm is sort of your deck and everything is victory points, right? You're trying to create a build for your farm that is going to be the most lucrative at the end once harvest season comes around. And it was confusing to me at first, but then I realized one of the really interesting keys of this game is that every round there's a new thing that you can add to your farm. And so remembering that certain things are about to happen that will really influence the game is important, because there's one mechanic that allows you to switch up who's the first player in each round. And the reason why that's important is that you're trying to gobble up resources that the other person needs, or be the first person to get to a resource that you both need. And that's an aspect that took me a while to keep in mind. So like one of the things that helps you out a lot is that the more people you have in your family, the more mouths you have to feed, but also each person counts for a turn, so you can grow faster. And remembering that the next turn is going to be the first time that you can have a baby is really important, because you want to be the person who has an extra turn before the other person, right? So like things like that, keeping that in mind and remembering what sort of resources the other person needs. And maybe you're sitting pretty and you're not sure what exactly you want to grab, but maybe you want to just like block off that resource that they need to sort of mess with them a little bit. Stuff like that. It wound up being super fun. And the first game I was slaughtered, like super, super slaughtered. And by the end, we only had a 1-point difference between us. So it was really, really fun. I enjoyed that game a lot. We played that for like an entire 6-hour plane ride.
For a long time, it was the top rated game on Board Game Geek. So for those who don't know, Agricola is a board game. There is an iOS version, which works pretty well, which also costs a lot less than the $60 or so that the board game costs. So that's what I said. Agricola also has a bunch of expansions. But it is a worker placement game. It's one of, I wouldn't call it one of the original worker placements, but it is one of the defining games in the genre. But a lot of people say Caverna has replaced it in their library as just being better game.
Caverna
is more
better.
Fun. Yeah.
It's kind of like how King of New York for a lot of people has replaced King of Tokyo.
And rightfully so, because King of New York, in my opinion, is a better game. I wouldn't say it's an objectively better board game, but it has a lot more to it than King of Tokyo does. So it's definitely replaced it in our board game rotation. So King of Tokyo doesn't get played anymore. It's interesting, because I don't feel that happens as much in video games as it does in board games, you know? That in board games, I see a lot of people will say, well, we like this board game in our collection. Then another board game came out that takes that idea and kind of does it better. So now we only play that. Does that happen as much in video games? Like, can you come up with an example of where a game has replaced another game for you?
APB to Grand Theft Auto Online.
Oh, okay. That's interesting. Yeah, because they do kind of do the same thing, but one kind of does it better.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of also like arguable on both fronts, but one is just I do think GTA is a little bit better just as a whole, just because you have The more flexibility with the planes and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Dump trucks and all that. You can just grab like a bunch of random stuff. But I'd say definitely GTO definitely replaced APB for me.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of examples of franchise titles that just replace. Like obviously, like Call of Duty probably replaces itself every year. Left 4 Dead 1 replaced got replaced by Left 4 Dead 2 because I mean, why wouldn't it? But I think it's very interesting to see when a game gets replaced by a game from a different company. You know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because that's like, okay, what did this game capture? What's the core thing that people played this game for? So why did this other game then do that better?
Right.
That happens a shitload in board games. I think because a board games share a lot of mechanics.
Mm-hmm.
And especially in video games, you can present those mechanics in radically different ways. So I think maybe that's an interesting thing.
I feel like, because some people in chat are using Secret Hitler as an example of just that idea in general. Like, Secret Hitler does a lot of those things better, right? In that genre of game, in that genre of,
Resistance and Avalon and One Night Ultimate Werewolf are all kind of in that social deduction genre.
Yeah, but I feel like I don't necessarily agree with that, because I think that after a while of playing Secret Hitler, I'd be like, I kind of want to play Werewolf. You know, like I would want like the mix up of ideas and themes more than anything, I think. Yes, Jesse?
No, having played Secret Hitler and then at PAX South gone back and played those games, I miss Secret Hitler tremendously. I was like, it just feels like a better game. And it feels like those other games are now like, I don't want to say obsolete, but kind of obsolete. Because there's you feel like there's something missing from it, and you're lacking like that extra feel of Secret Hitler. Yeah, it's I don't know.
It happens. It does. It happens a lot in board games. You know, there's a channel called the Dice Tower, which is probably revered as like the channel when it comes to board games. They produce a ridiculous number of videos, like an insane amount. But they often have these top tens where they're like, these are the top 10 games that replaced the games we used to play in this particular genre of board games.
Wow, and that's very specific.
Yes, yeah, because it happens so much, you know, because you just shelve one game, you basically retire one game because another game comes out that maybe iterated on a concept and just did it better. And Secret Hitler is a great example of that, because the previous games in the genre, like Resistance and Mafia, etc., I just feel Secret Hitler does it better. It's better executed, better paced, has more interesting mechanics, has a better theme, so you just play that instead.
Yeah.
Which is kind of cool.
Yeah, I'm going through my list here. I can't actually find anything else. I think the APB to GTA was kind of like the only example that I could even think of in this space.
Yeah.
Just going on the list, I can't find anything else. Everything else
outside of direct sequels, you know?
Yeah.
I think fighting games easily replace each other.
Okay.
I think that when you find a fighting game that really suits your style of how you want to play it, and feels more intuitive to you, you wind up playing that almost exclusively.
That's a good example, definitely. I think sometimes MOBAs do that too. Mm-hmm. If you like the genre in general, but there's something maybe about the business model or about the way that it's currently balanced you don't like, and you move on to another one. You know, I think people have replaced Dota 2 with League of Legends. People have replaced League of Legends with Dota 2. Or maybe they're like, you know what? I like the concept of MOBAs, but I want it in third person, so I'm going to go play Smite, you know? Or something along those lines. So
I think it's in that situation, I think it's almost more interesting that people do it with board games, because board games are like a snippet of your life, right?
Yeah.
Like, you sit down to play a board game, and in a couple of hours, you've played an entire game.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas with something like a MOBA or like an MMO, I think it's once somebody finds one and invests in it, it's hard for them to leave.
Yes.
So absolutely, that aspect is another variable I think that you don't get with a board game, unless it's like a tabletop RPG like D&D.
Yeah, that is very true. I mean, board games have a ton of replayability, obviously, but you often have a lot of them, and you rotate it out kind of based on the group that you're with, because there are some groups that just don't work well with certain games. You know, I wouldn't play Secret Hitler with people that I wasn't already friends with, because you can get into some really nasty arguments over that game. And if you don't know the people, and you don't know that you're willing to make those accusations purely in the context of the game, people can get genuinely upset, you know? Because it is a social experience. And then there are some games that I know are just too heavy for a particular group. You know, I'd never say, hey, let's play Twilight Imperium with my neighbors, you know? It's like a bunch of 50-year-old guys that, no, you're not going to play Twilight Imperium with me. That's like 6 hours long minimum, you know? It's too heavy. So you adapt.
That's not the Cold War game, is it?
No, that's Twilight Struggle.
Twilight Struggle.
Very similar. Yeah, I can see why you get confused, though. I get confused between those all the time. But Twilight Struggle is a very, very good game, but it is about the Cold War,
yeah,
and
it's
very
a game
strategic.
That's, like, super serious.
Yes, super serious game. Probably wouldn't play. You know, it's not a family game. You know,
it doesn't sound like a fun game.
It's a fantastic game. You know, it's like you know how Papers, Please was a really awesome game. People like Papers, Please sounds boring as shit. Yeah, and board games go even further. You know, one of the most popular games right now is called Splendor. It's literally a game about making jewelry. That's all it is. Make jewelry for nobles. And people fucking love it. There's a game called Sushi Go, which is about making sushi. That's all it is. And people love it. It's really interesting that board games can have really weird themes and yet still be fucking interesting and awesome. You know? Whereas I think video games struggle a lot more in that regard. It's a lot harder to make those games fun as a video game. But it's not impossible, you know? Cook Serve Delicious was really popular on PC and on iOS. And that's a game about making food. And then, of course, Papers, Please is a game about stamping passports. And that was awesome.
Yeah.
And getting people arrested.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Glory to Aristotska.
You're going to jail.
You got to feed your family. That comes first.
Yep.
F them.
Family first. I'll take that bribe. Absolutely.
F them.
Oh, my God. Whenever I watch somebody play and they're the sort of person where they literally turn everyone over, I'm like, shit, heartless. So heartless.
But are they? They're protecting the glory of Aristotchka, which is totally fair, you know? Yeah. They're doing their job. They're patriots.
Promoted.
They're fucking patriots.
But maybe they just left it at home.
It's them or me. Yeah.
Maybe they didn't. Maybe they're there to blow some shit up.
Yeah. Tough shit. I got my balls groped by the TSA when I came into Charlotte. You know, it's just going to happen, you know?
Sure.
Everyone else has to endure that, too. If I have to endure that, so do they.
Damn right.
Glory to Aristotchka.
Damn right.
Great. Glory to Aristotchka.
Don't stay at the airport.
No. Absolutely not.
A game that I played at PAX and then played again once I got back. I don't know. Did you wind up mentioning a game called Gurgamoth Lives?
How the fuck do you spell that?
Nope. I definitely did it.
God damn, I've got to put the title now in. I can't spell it. Gurgamoth?
G-U-R-G-A. M-O-T-H. Gurgamoth Lives.
G-U-R-G-A.
M-O-T-H.
M-O-T-H. Lives.
Lives.
Great.
Gurgamoth Lives.
I googled it and I got Gorgoroth, who are a black metal band. That is not what I was looking for whatsoever. But okay.
So Gurgamoth Lives is a multiplayer game. It is a local multiplayer game that was made in a game jam and then they sort of expanded on it. But every map, you are in sort of a blank canvas with spikes on all sides.
Okay.
There are four players who all float and have the ability to attack or dash. But even your attacks are kind of a dash. Like, you just run into the other person.
Seems like there's a lot of momentum involved in this game. Yeah.
A lot of momentum. It's a very, very fast-paced game.
Okay.
You are trying to sacrifice everyone else on the map in order to raise Gurgamoth.
Okay.
And the game winds up being really fun. It's fairly repetitive. I will absolutely be open about that.
It looks very simple.
Yeah, but it winds up being really fun. You wind up with, like, kind of interesting tactics. I don't know, because, when I was playing it originally at PAX South, there was a guy who had obviously been there he just wouldn't leave. Like, he just kept playing this game, and people would rotate in and out and whatever else. And I was standing there waiting to play, and I wound up hopping up there. And the second we started playing, he dive-bombed me, and I died on the spikes. And I was like, all right. Second time we played, I was like, oh, I'll dodge out of the way. I went to dodge, and he still dive-bombed me into the spikes. And I was like, all right, okay, I see how this is going to go. And then the next time we played, I dive-bombed him and smashed him into the spikes above him, and it was the most satisfying feeling in the world because your like blood sticks around on the outside. So like if you just keep murdering the same person over and over and over again, you just cover the whole thing in their blood. Apparently they're adding more to it, but it was just like a a simple local multiplayer game that they made in a game jam and then sort of cleaned up. But I thought that it was pretty fun. I wound up playing it a decent amount. So there's that. If you're looking for something that's kind of not as intricate as Towerfall, but definitely has that feel of like a bunch of people frantically trying to murder each other, you know?
Yeah, it gives me a bit of a dive kick feel. And honestly, like, really, the principles behind this are the same principles that are in fighting game. What you just described is actually how fighting games work at a very high level, but based on kind of a single action. Because you're trying to, well, fighting games are really not actually about fighting at all. They're about figuring out what your opponent's doing and doing the thing which breaks that.
Right.
And what you just described is exactly like that. You know, he had a strategy, you figured out the counter to it, and then he's going to try and figure out the counter to what you're doing, and it gradually evolves as you play the same person more and more and more. And that's what's really interesting about games like that. The problem is that if you don't have enough depth to it, then it can get a bit samey, which it looks like this game might in its current state.
Yeah, it does get a little samey, but I continued to have fun with it regardless, so...
Yeah, even if it does get repetitive, like games like this, it's as much as I'm not a fan of local multiplayer... Like, I feel like I have enough now that if I do have people come over, I could probably have a pretty nice playlist of games. Like Towerfall, Crawl, a game like Gurgamoth
Lives, Nidhogg, Star Wars, things like
getting,
that.
Getting all these, just rotate through them. Just like, get a new drink, get a new game. Just like that.
I think you're exactly right there. I think that's absolutely the way to go with it, which is why like Sports Friends was a great package, because you got a bunch of those games together. Because they knew, no one's going to play fucking this for 10 hours. But we'll play it for like 20 minutes and then move on to another one, you know? But if you overplay it and it's not Duck Game, which you can play for hours as far as I'm concerned, then you will get bored of it. And I think that like, you've got to price those games appropriately as a result, or make them into compilations. It's like, would you pay for the individual components of Jackbox Party Pack? I'd probably play for Fibbage, but I probably would not pay like individually for any of the other games, you know. But that's why they packaged them together, you know, because they knew the other games weren't as good.
Drawful are the two that I have played a lot of, and then everything else is sort of like, ah, I'll try this one out again. Ah, it's not as good as Fibbage or Drawful.
Yeah, and that's definitely the way to go with it. And Sports Friends kind of has a standout product as well. But if you're not going to do that, then you really have to price your game appropriately, because especially for local multiplayer, if you're going to ask me for maybe more than at most $10 for that, I'm probably going to say no.
Yeah.
I think you should price that game at like $3. Make an impulse buy. So everyone has a copy of it, and when someone comes over, hey, let's play this for like 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Everyone will own it. Everyone will have it available, and do it that way.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. And if you don't do that and you overprice it, then I think you're killing your game. I really do. But that does sound like fun. Mm-hmm. I played a game that we played at CoxCon. CoxCon. Do you remember Spellweaver, the card game?
I
play. Yes. It's out on Steam now, and I played some. And it's pretty good. If you are a fan of Hearthstone, but wanted something that's a little bit more in-depth and has a little bit more player interaction, that's what Spellweaver is. So, as opposed to Hearthstone, where when it's not your turn you can't do shit, you can do a couple of things. Like, for instance, you can block. So, kind of like Magic the Gathering. So you can put a blocker in. And you can also interrupt certain abilities. But it's not as crazy as Magic the Gathering. Like, you can't respond to absolutely fucking everything. Like, if somebody plays, as far as I can tell anyway, bearing in mind I've played, like, probably about 10 games of it so far, if someone plays a creature, you can't respond to that. You know? So, like, Magic, if someone plays a creature, you have a response time. But in this, you don't have that. You also have a front and back line. So, creatures in your back line are protected, but you can't attack with them. So you can put, like, support creatures in the back line with powers and shit, but you can't attack with them. And there are certain powers that allow you to drag, to rearrange people. So I was playing a faction that could attach a grappling hook to someone's arm as an implant, which would gradually ruin their health, but it allowed me to hook in one of the backlying dudes to the front so I could then beat the shit out of him. So that was pretty cool. It's got a pretty nice art style. The characters have powers, and they also can kind of level up in game.
Yeah, you can level up heroes and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. So you can gain access to abilities, and it kind of works. It has land, kind of like Magic does, but they have a mechanic which lets you search for land if you don't have any. So you can sacrifice a card to search the top five cards of your deck for a land and then play it.
Interesting. Okay.
And if you don't need... The lands work in different ways. So you can either use them to level you up, or you can use them to add one mana and draw a card. So it helps with the land starving thing that Magic the Gathering has, but it doesn't take that element away entirely.
When I see a game like this, like I'm looking at some of the screenshots, and it looks beautiful.
It's gorgeous.
There's so much intricacy here, and it's like, but when I look at it, it's like, that'll take me forever to learn. Just the art style itself tells me that's going to take me forever to learn.
No.
It has a really good trailer, and it gives you a starter deck right off the bat, and it's pretty easy to get a hang on. Bear in mind, though, I have played a lot of TCGs, so I'm maybe not the best person to ask. But
I'm
not
very good at TCGs, and I caught onto it pretty fast when we were there.
It's pretty easy to catch onto. I don't really know about the business model yet. It seems fair. Like, I'm getting a lot of packs for not doing anything, you know, and it seems like you can buy a lot with in-game gold, but I don't know how it's going to be later on, you know, because a lot of people complain about Hearthstone being just a real pain in the ass if you don't pay money for it. It's really hard to get competitive. I don't know about this yet, but so far it's pretty good. I've had quite a lot of fun with it. I said great card art. It would be nice if they unlocked the frame rate, because it would make the game a little bit smoother, because it's locked at 30, which is not a big deal for a TCG, but it's still, it's a lot smoother when it's a higher frame rate, but I actually like it quite a bit. So, it's all right. What else has anyone been playing?
I'm playing this game right now. It's called Subterrain. It's an indie game.
Is it Subterrain or Subterranea?
It's just Subterrain.
Subterrain. Cool. Yeah. Okay.
I've already got way more hours than I typically put into these things when I do like coverage for them.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because it's a survival game. It's a top-down survival game. There's a lot of management elements here. Most survival games, because there's tons of them, right?
Yes.
Most survival games, you're like, okay, I have to manage my thirst, my hunger, and maybe my fatigue, right? Mm-hmm. In this one, you're in a Mars station, so you have to manage your suit energy, the oxygen, the actual temperature of the station that you're in, or the part of the station that you're in, which means you have to manage the power to that part of the station. You also have your hunger, your thirst, your fatigue, pretty normal stuff there. Then you have to manage how often you shit and piss.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
It's a like toilet simulator 2016, all right.
Everything. And it sucks that you can't just, like, you know, take a dump anywhere in this abandoned station, right? But you have to take it in a potty first.
Hygiene is important.
There's actually a guy, one of the reviews is a guy just listing all the ways he's died. And, like, he's like, drop my shotgun because I fired it too many times and it got too hot for the character, so I didn't have a weapon. Like, all right, that's a shitty way to go.
This game? Because the UI looks so familiar.
It's a manage everything game, basically. Off the top of my head, I can't remember who exactly, but...
I'm going to find out who made it.
Pixel Lore made this?
Pixel Lore?
Is the only game they have on Steam.
Right.
I don't know what else they've done.
There's like mutants and all that stuff, and like the zombies and whatnot. So on paper, it's not very cliche, but once you get in, you have to actually manage all this stuff. You're just like, it feels way more in depth, almost way more in depth than it needs to be. But still, it made it a lot of fun because now it's like, like you said, you shoot a weapon too many times, it gets too hot, you drop it. And so you have to like switch to something else.
Hmm.
But that's pretty much like the indie game of the week for me right now.
Yeah, there's a video on your channel if people want to go check it out over at akaMikeB. So go have a look at that. I think it's your indie for breakfast.
Yes, it is. Really.
Yep. So feel free. Oh, did your mic just come back? That's great, because you sounded robotic for the last 10 minutes, thanks to Skype.
I know. I was at the mercy of Skype.
Yeah,
you sounded fine to me.
Yeah, it's always the case of like it's the different connections between different people. So like it can sound good for one person, not good for others.
Yeah.
You've kind of come back now, so that's good.
Space. Maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
You
it did look kind of Dead Spacey.
Huh? Yeah, it's probably inspired by that, I'd imagine.
The UI and Subterrain.
Yeah, it does give me a little bit of a vibe of that.
Mm-hmm.
Jesse, you seem like crouched over and ready to pounce. What's up?
No, I don't know if I can even talk about it. Like, I was gonna say that this week I literally, like, after the last podcast, was told, "Hey, you need to be on a plane tomorrow." And
you went to Boston, right?
Yeah, and then flew away. So I literally have played nothing. And then I got back, and then I was like, "Well, I'm gonna take a break because I've lost my voice from filming."
Fair.
So But I guess it kind of counts as a game, and it was pretty dope.
All right.
Dodger, are we legally allowed to talk about Boda Borg? Can we talk about that?
Oh, I don't. I actually don't know, so we probably shouldn't.
I will say that at PAX East, if anyone wants to go chill with me at Boda Borg, I'm totally going because I want to solve
it. I'll go with you.
Boda Borg is. Boda Borg is a thing. It's an escape room thing.
Ah.
Except it's Swedish or Norwegian or something like that.
It started in Sweden. It's made up of multiple different escape rooms that are constantly.
Like 14, maybe?
Yeah. That are all in the same building. And each escape room, each like themed escape room is at least three rooms in a row. And so you have to like, you have to correctly solve each room. And if you don't solve the room that you're currently in, you have to go out and start over from the beginning.
And it was legit the most, like, I've been to many escape rooms. This was like the most video game-esque escape room situation I've ever been to. Like, I'm gonna talk about one. I'm not gonna talk about the other ones that we really did, but like the very first one we did.
Are you gonna spoil this? Because I need
No. I'm just gonna describe what it was. I'm not gonna tell you how we solved it or anything like that. So,
I was gonna say because I've known you for far too long and you
I'm ready on this button.
If I even get an indication, I'm pressing it.
I wouldn't even do that to those guys because it would ruin one of the puzzles of something that you have to pay for to like do. I wouldn't.
Yeah.
But so. You're thrown in basically a jail cell. It's a tiny jail, like a real, it has the bunks, it has a sink and everything. And it's like, all right, there's a hole under the sink. Crawl through that shit. Now you're in the pipeworks. And the objective is like, don't touch the ground. You need to move along the pipes without being detected. It is super effing dope. And it's just like, I was like, I've been to escape rooms. It's like, I have to put these puzzle pieces together. This was like next level. It was so cool. And it only got, like, crazier. Like, there was a scary one, like a spook house one. There was one that was basically Dodger, Jesse, and Sam climb on shit and fall in the... Like,
and we started chanting because we were like, we need to get out of this. We have to pull together like a team.
Needless to say, Jesse on whatever those swinging, like, sticks in the, or whatever the hell it is, swinging planks in the air as you try to bounce across multiple of them.
That sounds a lot more physical than a regular escape room.
Some of them are. Yeah, they specify if they are.
They have, like, red level, green level, and black level. And the last one we did, like, the one where shit's swinging was black level. They have one called, like, toughest, which is, like, supposed to be the hardest shit there, and you just need to, like,
It's supposed to be, like, ultimate ninja,
super physical.
The escape room.
Oh, wow.
Some of them are, you have to use your brain. There's one where we're, like, I don't know how we clicked into it. It was amazing. And it was like Dodger had a moment of just like, like super joy. But several of them are, it's super physical. You're swinging from stuff. You're holding on things. But it felt like the situations and the way they sold it, because everything's automated and there's a little green light or red light, whether you pass or fail. And so it is one of those things where you do it and then a guy comes in, like replaces all of it. It's one of those things where everything has a failure state and a win state. And you will know immediately if you sucked or immediately if you passed. Like, it felt so gratifying in ways I can't... It was like... I was like, this is like a real-life game almost.
Well, that's exactly what that kind of thing is. You know, I did an escape room a while ago, and I fucking loved it. I would happily do them again. They're a really cool concept. I'm glad to see they're finally kind of, you know... Because they were very, very niche for a long time, and now they're starting to spread across the country, and that's great, because they... It literally is a real-life video game. You know, it's usually puzzles, but obviously it seems like this has a physical element to it, too.
Oh, yeah.
This is so fun. Yeah. Also, apparently, the guy who owns the place was saying that the original version of all of these puzzles that exists in Sweden, like the Boda Borg that's in Sweden, each room has a clue that you read before you go in the room. And he was like, we figured you guys don't need that. They got rid of all of the clues at this point. So you walk in blind. Yeah. And when we found that out, we were like, that's kind of rad. Because, like, when you figure it out, you feel so smart. We're like, we didn't need a fucking hint. We didn't need a clue.
Yeah, the spook house was literally the, like, passion of three gamers not giving up. We were so stumped. We were just like, what the do you do? And then it just, like, clicked. And we were like...
I screamed, and everyone outside heard me scream.
It was, like, such an amazing moment. And then the next one, like, came even faster, and we were like, we're finally getting the shit. And then, of course, it was like, now you're doing the one where you have to go, like, swing across ropes and, like, walk on beams and shit. We're like, oh, no.
It's super fun, though.
Mm-hmm. It was great.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you ever get a chance to do an escape room, especially with friends, I would strongly recommend you do it. It's a lot of fun. It's a really cool cooperative experience, and it is like a real-life video game. And I think you'll get the same thing out of it that you do out of video games, just you get to do it in real life, which is kind of neat.
Yeah, if you're going to PAX East, like, take your friends, go there, chill out. It's one of those things where, like, they do 700 people a day or something crazy like that on the weekend.
That's huge. Yeah, that's crazy. Yeah.
When we were there, it was packed. Like, there were people everywhere.
Yeah, I can see. I mean, just looking at these pictures, it just looks like they just have people just chaining in, go through one part to another.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And taco bar, guys. Fucking taco.
They do have an all-you-can-eat taco bar.
They have an all-you-can-eat taco bar. I'm just fucking saying. Mm-hmm. Sign yourself up. Go run through some shit. Eat a taco. You're good. That's a good day.
Mm-hmm. Cool. I played some Crashlands. It's another game.
How do you like that?
I think it's pretty good, actually.
Yeah.
It has a really cool feature where you can sync your save to your PC from your iPad and vice versa, which is a pretty rare feature for iOS in particular, because I'm pretty sure Apple just don't let you do that by default. So in order to make that happen, you have to code your own server to store the data and have your own login account. So they did that. And that was awesome, because I thought I was going to have to restart with the PC version. Like, no. You can just sync your iOS game because it's identical. So, like, okay, this is cool. And, I mean, the game is very much a mix of Terraria and Don't Starve. It is kind of designed for mobile in the sense that they have optimized the way that the inventory works. So you have an infinite inventory, managing it's really easy. It has little hotkeys down the bottom, although on PC it's a lot easier because you can sync those hotkeys to real keys, which is really handy. The problem I'm having with it is that they have taken away a lot of the, I wouldn't call it the exploration element of it. What I would call it is the aspect of not really knowing what you're doing from the start. They've taken that away, and they've made it very clear by giving you a bunch of quests. And I'm kind of waiting for the quests to stop. Because right now, it seems like even 4 hours into the game, I'm still in the tutorial. You know, that's because I'm getting quests just like, oh, I can teach you how to fish. Or, oh, I can teach you how to make a pickaxe, which will let you mine this. And da 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 da. And I'm just like, when is that going to end?
It's not unlocking it for you. It's just showing you how to do it, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, you have to do the quest to get that item. Like, you can't, as far as I can tell, you can't do it on your own. So you have to do the quest to do that. But I'm seeing in the trailer there's all sorts of things like level 33 armor, and you could build water pumps and all sorts of other shit. So it seems like eventually you will get to the stage where you're really able to do interesting stuff on your own. And the loot system is really cool, too. It has a direct crafting system, which will produce different quality items with different stats on them. So every chess piece I make is different. So, you know, I can make an epic chess piece of vampirism with 3% chance to go berserk and all this other shit. Or I can make a shitty chess piece with 2% toughness, you know? So it gives you a reason to keep farming resources so you can keep remaking the shit that you don't like. Also, you have a pet. You have a pet Wompit. And you can feed it, and you can milk it, which is a bit weird. And you can also give it a garter, which makes it even weirder. And the garter buffs it up. And apparently you can have different kinds of pets that all react differently. So it's pretty neat, actually.
Did I just see in the trailer that it says that it has an inventory that is unlimited and manages itself?
Yep. Unlimited inventory manages itself.
What?
Yep.
How?
Yep. It does. It's really cool. Like, I have never had to fuck around with inventory once. Apparently you can have any mob in the game as a pet, according to chat, which seems cool. I've only been able to get the one pit right now. I haven't found an egg for anything else. But it, apparently, according to someone beat the game and it just keeps doing the questing thing, which is kind of annoying because I think it's very tutorial-like. Yes? Yeah.
So, manages itself.
Mm-hmm.
Can you reorganize? Like, can you say, I don't want it organized by type. I want it organized by last item I got.
Good question. Let me load the game.
important question.
Let me see if that is true.
I've never
felt the need to do that. So, sync cloud saves now. Load from my PC. There we go.
That's
sexy.
Yeah,
it's super sexy. It's loading the map. There we go.
So you said you can't even see your inventory? What?
Yeah, you can. There's two different... The inventory is managed in two different ways. Because there's the stuff you need to build.
Okay.
So there's an inventory screen for that, which has a list of all the stuff you can place on the ground, and also has a list of all the flooring you can make. So those two things are to the side. Let's see if I can kind of show you there. This is terrible. This isn't helping you at all, is it? No, this
totally
is
helping. Totally
no, this
helping.
Is
working. Yeah.
Why am I doing it this way? Right.
It's kind of helping.
Yeah. So you see the inventory there. So you can raise it, kind of place that, and then there's a character inventory, which has gear slots, tool slots, accessory slots, and four hot buttons.
Okay.
Which kind of looks like this.
Oh,
and
okay.
God damn it. And when you press on one of those, you can just unequip, and it's like, these are the items I can equip in that slot. You know? So, you don't really need to manage the inventory, because really, it's all kind of done through equipment. I think potentially, maybe you could get so much shit that, that there'd be too much shit to place down. But you can also salvage anything you don't need. So you can salvage it and get some of the components back. So you can get rid of all that shit. So it really doesn't need anything else. Like, I don't think you can manage it in any other way, from what I can tell. But I don't think you'd ever need to. Yeah, there's no other way to manage it. But I don't see why you'd ever need to.
Right.
Honestly.
Interesting.
Yeah, so, you know, if you like if you're thinking about a mix of Don't Starve, it's got less survival elements, definitely. I don't really... You can build a house, but I'm trying to figure out whether or not you ever get attacked in it. I don't think you do.
Right.
It's like, why am I putting floors down? Is it just cosmetic? I don't know yet. But but I do like the fact that it kind of mixes Terraria's kind of cool loot system with Don't Starve. It has a better combat system than Don't Starve does, but it has a lot less of the survival aspect. Like, going out at night isn't really a risk. You just... Mm-hmm. You just get it automatically equips a torch as soon as it gets dark, so it's not like you're going insane or anything. So if you want the survival... No, it's infinite. You can get upgradable torches, though, but they're all infinite. So it's like, it almost maybe feels like they maybe have taken out a little bit too much from because that made Terraria and Don't Starve special in the name of making it more convenient.
Yeah, like, Don't Starve is hard.
Yes.
And playing Don't Starve on iOS is even worse.
Oh, yeah.
So it's. I understand. If somebody wants to take a game and take those elements and make it more accessible, then fine.
Yeah. The interface on iOS is really good, but it's also good on PC, too. Like, it plays... The controls are good on both. Like, the only minor complaint I have about the PC version is that you can't scroll the map with your mouse. You could use the keys. But outside of that, it's like, yeah, this plays really well. So it's an interesting interpretation of the two that maybe people might enjoy, simply because they made a lot of it more convenient.
Mm-hmm.
And that convenience aspect is actually pretty cool. So yeah, Crashlands, not too bad. Like it.
Crashlands.
Let's go to a break. Let's do that. We'll come back. I mean, I could talk a lot more about XCOM 2, but honestly, I don't see the point, because I think I've covered XCOM 2 in way too much detail, and you guys haven't even played it yet, right?
Nope.
Nope.
So I haven't touched it.
But I will say that the co-optional character pack is now available for download for free. I put it up on Twitter. So if you... Let me see if I can give you the link here. Yeah. If you go to nexusmods.com/xcom2/mods/114... I need to turn my phone off. Then you will be able to download the co-optional character pack, which is 11 co-optional people and friends, I guess. All with their own unique bios and looks and everything. And Jesse Cox is the thumbnail. He's looking rather handsome there. So you can go and download that character pack, and the instructions for installing it are there. Really, really easy. So that's all available. Also, I would like to congratulate the winner of the Secret Hitler Highlight Contest. We finally found a winner. We had over 100 entries, so I really apologize if we missed any of them, because I think a couple of people maybe we didn't download because there was so many. So that's like so many hours of footage, so we apologize if we missed yours. But the winner... is Glenn Carlate, I think. I can't pronounce his name. Glenn Carlart. You're now Glenn Carlart. That video is now up on the channel right now. You can go watch it if you so desire. And it was a really fun highlight reel, really well edited. So congratulations. He wins the $150 prize. All right.
Awesome.
We are going to a break. When we come back, we're going to talk about the news. We got Hearthstone news. We've got game trailers news. We've got all sorts of things. So you're watching the Co-Optional Podcast. Do not go anywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the Co-Optional Podcast. Mike, is your mic better, Mike?
Yeah, I mean, is it better?
Sounds better. Sounds better. Cool. Yeah. Excellent. Glad to hear it. Hopefully Skype doesn't screw up again.
Thank you.
All right, well... We actually have a lot of news this week, lots to cover, so let's get right into it with something of a bit of an obituary for... It's kind of weird. Like, it's almost like seeing a group that you've kind of been in competition with for a while, and yet had a respect for.
Had a great deal of respect for yeah.
Yeah, especially since we've actually had members of their...
Fucking chair, goddammit.
Yeah, we've had members of their fucking chair on the show, yep. Which included Kyle Bossman, who, of course, was actually on about 2 years ago, the final Bossman. And the unfortunate reality is that GameTrailers.com is now dead. They were actually only alerted a couple of hours before the whole thing closed down. And they basically said, yeah, we're shutting down. We're done. GameTrailers has been, for the longest time, probably the biggest direct competition to those of us producing YouTube content on video games. Mm-hmm. And they put a lot of good stuff out. You know, they had some good editorial. They had a selection of staff who would produce shows that were high quality. The final Bossman being a great example of that.
So good, yeah.
And they're now dead. They're just gone. Apparently, Defy Media shut them down. They apparently were bought by Viacom years ago and then gutted. So, now I think, outside of Twitch, that's now the biggest direct competition to YouTube when it comes to gaming footage. Gone. Just obliterated from the internet.
Yeah.
Just actually kind of sad.
It is pretty sudden, given, like, only, what, 4 months ago or so, they were talking about changes they were going to make to get onto Defy Media's platform.
Yes.
And then after that, I mean, that was just 4 months ago. And then what happened? Where it's just all of a sudden, no, never mind.
Yeah, weird thing is about it that they, you know, they were still getting quite a lot of views on certain videos, mm-hmm. especially like the big stuff that they were producing. Yes, Jesse.
I mean, they had a lot of great quality shows, and Game Trailers is definitely where I found some of the things that I like back in the day really fell in love with, and like helped inspire like this whole Jesse doing YouTube thing, and I will never not like thank them for that, because even to this day some of those shows are like some of my favorites. Mm-hmm. I can't help but feeling though that like knowing the potential for an, like, their audience fell off. Like, this is one of those things where they had a, like, ignore the people who are like our friends and all that stuff for a minute. Like, I feel bad that they were thrown into the same situation a lot of companies are when they're bought by someone bigger and are expected to always consistently turn a profit. This was definitely 100% a you're not making us money, buy move. I mean, that's what this was. And I can't help but feel like it's because the audience that they should have had was not there. And it's sad to say, like, it sucks that no one watched Game Trailers, but that's super hindsight. Because when Game Trailers was around, it was one of those things that, you know, now people are like, it was truly one of the greatest things ever. Like, where were these people a week and a half ago, 2 weeks ago? When people really needed to watch it to keep it alive. And it's really sad to me to see yesterday and today all these Twitter comments that are like, rest in peace, Game Trailers, you were amazing. Where were you when they needed you so they could still be around? Like,
well,
it's really
just
aggravating.
It's changing times, you know. People are not actually that willing to go to different places to find content. They want it all in one place, which is why Twitch dominates game live streaming and YouTube dominates game VODs. And everywhere else is fighting really hard to survive. Really, really hard. And Game Trailers was that. You know, towards the end of the lifespan, you know, things like Final Bossman were just embeds of YouTube videos. Like, Game Trailers used to host their own shit. And I'm just really... I'm not surprised by it, because YouTube basically took it over. Back when Game Trailers first came out, gaming on YouTube was barely even a thing. You know, you couldn't do it. Machinima was really the only person doing it. So Gametrailers had a big market share. And that market share disappeared over time as YouTube basically stole all of it. And that's what happened. The annoying thing about Gametrailers is that years ago, and I think that to some degree they did this, some of the people on Gametrailers should have maybe realized kind of the way the tide was turning and really established themselves on YouTube.
Absolutely.
Because here's the thing. The shows that they produced did not require the investment of Gametrailers. Like, they didn't require a lot of camera crew. They didn't require a lot of high-end equipment. They weren't doing stuff that was on the level of Giant Bomb, where I think that, you know, Giant Bomb needs the TriCaster and the producer and shit like that.
But wouldn't you say that when you have something embedded on your website and a lot of people watch it there, you would see a very obvious money drop moving over to a platform like YouTube?
Yeah,
where,
in theory. Because you should be able to monetize your site better than YouTube can just monetize it. That's the theory. I think you might have a little bit of experience in this, Mike, actually, when it comes to monetization and embedding with XAMN in particular.
Yeah, so with XAMN, actually, we had worked on a project very similar to this where we were looking at moving off of YouTube to host everything locally. So we put together all the numbers and everything for it. And let me tell you, you need a very large, or at least a very dedicated and connected direct sales team in order to make money on that. Because you're not going to make money off of just random, you know, Google ads that you slap onto videos because of the event. You're paying for the bandwidth. And so if someone watches a video, you're paying for every bit that guy gets, you're paying for it. And so that's why a lot of people switch over to YouTube, is because we know for a fact that it plays on everything. It scales super well.
Yep.
And we don't have to pay a dime for their hosting. So in the end, you kind of almost end up making the same amount of money.
Except for the 50% they take up front.
Yeah, but it's, I mean, 45%. Even that, it's like,
whatever
that,
it
that,
is.
Yeah. And that's why you see a lot of interstitial ads. It's like, for example, what we do on the show, where we actually have brands and sponsors and such. That's why you see a lot of those, because you don't make enough money off of just the upfront ads.
You know, just as an example, obviously I won't give you the exact amount, but I will say that the sponsorship makes maybe 4 or 5 times what the total YouTube monetization of the show does.
Yeah.
That's for one episode.
That sounds
It's a big deal. Direct sponsorships will make you a lot more.
And that's the other thing, too. Doing videos of this length, 3 hours, like, there's no way you're going to host that yourself.
No!
Right? There's no way you're going to pay
for
that.
You can't do it.
Someone's just going to right-click download, and now you've paid for every single cent that guy has, or every single byte that guy has taken.
Yeah, and he was probably ad-blocking in the process. You know, people wonder why some of us get a bit annoyed about ad-blocking. Like, look, Google can afford for you to ad-block. We can't, and these sites absolutely can't. You know, as soon as, you know, they start paying for the bandwidth, when you're ad blocking, you are taking their bandwidth and not compensating them for it. And they'll die, you know? I have no doubt that ad blocking is part of the reason why Gametrailers is dead now. It's not the reason, but it'll be part of it, you know, because their reason was lack of revenue. And some of that revenue disappeared because of ad blocking. So, simple as that, really.
You can't deny it. One thing I do know that I think is something that is real sad is that Gametrailers had a lot of properties that they owned through deals or whatever, but like old series that I know a lot of people wanted to bring to YouTube and they did not let them.
Yeah. And which was a mistake, as it turns out, you know?
Huge mistake. Yeah. And so, but my hope is that through this kind of sad news, those properties will now be free to actually come back.
Mm.
There's a lot of great shows that were cut when Viacom?
Yeah, Viacom bought them years ago. Yeah.
Yeah.
When Viacom laid people off, a lot of shows were canceled. And I feel like they couldn't get them back, but maybe now they can.
I wonder if they can even get the IP. Like, if Viacom want to be super dicks about it, they'll probably hold on to the IP and say that you can't have it.
Well, Defy's now. I mean, Defy technically owns it, so...
Well, if Defy want to be dicks, you know, which is possible.
Yeah, you could probably do it low-key, but it's not worth the risk, because the second you get big, someone else is going to take that money.
I guess that's true.
I also wonder, like, if the other side of it, you know, besides obviously not making enough money, I mean, if you look at just their Social Blade stats on YouTube, it's like they have really good numbers if it wasn't a business.
Exactly.
Right?
Like, if it was just, one dude,
one guy, that'd be amazing.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. I'm just looking at their numbers. They're okay. I mean, bear in mind, like, if I look at their YouTube channel, I alone crush them as one person.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. You know? But if I was getting those numbers on YouTube, I'd be like, okay, yeah, I'm set, I'm good.
Yeah, you would be set as a person, day. Maybe too, you know? Yep. But the problem is, and this is why these big conglomerate sites are eventually going to fail, is their overheads are too high. Mm-hmm. They have to pay too many people to do too little. And you have diminishing returns on that. You know, as you produce more and more and more and more content, people can't read everything that you put out. So it happens on YouTube as well. It's the reason we don't make 5 videos a fucking day, because we get diminishing returns on it. So we've invested time, and yet we make less money. So, you know, it's about finding that optimal amount. And the problem is, like, you know, conglomerate sites are always going to run into that problem, because they've got like 10 different staffers all producing content at the same time, and no one has time to watch all of it. Yeah. So you end up with diminishing returns and higher overheads and smaller profit margins, and then this happens. But here's the thing. If someone like Kyle Bossman goes the Jim Sterling route, he'll be totally fine. He can make his show entirely on his own. There's nothing in that show that takes any more than one person to edit, you know?
Right.
So he could easily go solo on his own channel with the show, set up a Patreon to help start him off, and then he'll be totally fine, working as a solo act. And Brandon, I think, could probably do exactly the same thing. I think he's got enough of a following, and there's probably a couple of other guys there. I think they'll land on their feet. What I hope is that they don't go and join another site. Because unless they really enjoy the collaborative process, personally, I think that those people should really be going solo on YouTube, because they will be able to survive with Patreon donations and subs and things like that.
I hope that's the case, but I'm really curious to see, like, mentally after 10 plus years of working in a group, if going alone, like, that's scarring. Like, I'm going to do all this now myself, and anything good or bad that happens from this is on me.
It's my fault. Like, yeah.
That's the StarCraft 2 of a job right there.
And that's the thing I fucking love about it. You know? The buck stops here always. Like, yeah. I don't have to deal with other people's bullshit. If I fuck up, I know it was me that fucked up. I had control over that, so I can not fuck up the next time.
Yeah. So someone like him, he should actually license out a show to a company. Like, that's what
I'd say go solo, unless a company is willing to pay a good amount of money for that show.
Yeah, that's the point. You wouldn't do it for nothing. Like, you want to take your name, your brand that you built in, and then you basically license a show to a group.
Yeah.
And, you know, that show may not get any views, but you're getting paid, and that's another form of income.
That's another way to do it.
That's what you do.
Yeah, you can do that. Personally, I think Final Boss Man is probably popular enough to run on Patreon on its own. Just like Jimquisition was, you know?
Yeah.
If you've got a strong brand already that people know you for, you should be solo. There's no reason. I think Jim talked about this when he was saying, look, I wasn't getting any benefit from being with the Escapist anymore. Like, and it's actually the same with us with Polaris. In a big way, with this podcast, this very podcast, we were getting no benefit from having this show on the Polaris channel. Like, our brand was carrying theirs, not the other way around. So, if your brand isn't helping me, I shouldn't be working with you. There's no reason. Yeah. Unless you're paying me. In which case, cool. Yeah. If you want to pay for my content, you want to license out a show and pay me a flat rate to make that content, okay. But outside of that, no. I'm not going to do that. You know, either you commission me or I work alone, because it makes more sense for me to work alone. And I think it makes sense for these guys, too. There's nothing they were doing that they couldn't do themselves. They don't need a 10-person fucking crew to do it.
Yeah, I guess it entirely depends on what all was included in a contract like that. If they also own the Final Bossman, because it was part of Gametrailers.
I hope not. If he gets fucked over because of that, and that really sucks, because there's a lot of strength in that brand. If he has to change his name, that will hurt him.
It's a weird situation. I mean, you just have to look at the history of Gametrailers, and that when Viacom bought them, they got rid of a lot of people. And so it makes me wonder, like, what, like, how much money actually they were making at the time as a site was. I just don't understand why Viacom would just liquidate a huge majority of the people working there. And then it got bought again. Like, it's just a lot of backstory there that I don't understand. Like, people got fired. Then it got rebought again, and it almost makes you wonder if Viacom and Defy had a business deal and something. Like, there's a lot of stuff going on in that story that I just don't know. And I feel like we just know, like, a little fraction of it, but it sucks that the fraction we know is that a bunch of guys who put out really good work are just done. Like, that sucks.
Mm-hmm.
Hopefully
they'll
land on their feet, but, again, I go back to my original point. If people cared, they should have been watching it before they got
Yeah, a lot of people came out of the woodwork to lament the loss. You know, it's like, well, yeah, you probably didn't watch them in the first place.
You don't
know
what you got till it's gone, y'all.
True enough. Mm-hmm. But,
hindsight,
you know,
is 2020.
I think it was inevitable. You know, YouTube dominates that VOD scene now, and while it was good that they had competition, like, it barely was, you know, because those guys were just hosting stuff on YouTube, like, at that point. So they weren't really competition anymore. Yeah. And it sucks, because as we've certainly experienced the last few weeks, YouTube has got a lot of problems. You know, the recent, if you watched the recent Grade video about the bullshit that YouTube has been pulling when it comes to DMCAs and takedowns and just nuking channels out of existence, you know, I Hate Everything got nuked out of existence for no reason, you know, with no explanation. Got suspended, apparently, for a brief time for no reason. You know, YouTube is, they keep saying they're on the side of the creators, but they have to prove that. And
well, it's just like Twitch having, like, banning games and then not getting back to the devs about why.
Yeah, that's bullshit
too. The devs
will
contact them and be like, hey, why are you saying that people can't play my game? Because, like, Twitch can make or break whether or not a game gets streamed anywhere.
Yes.
Because Twitch is the biggest streaming platform, right?
Yeah,
so, like, I think that the devs totally deserve an explanation for what specifically is going against the terms of service, but they never get a response. I think that's kind of fucked up.
Agree.
Yeah, I would agree with that totally. And Twitch is inconsistent as fuck when it comes to banning people, by the way. You know, there are big streamers that break the rules constantly, and Twitch doesn't give a shit because they have lots of subs and they're making money. You know, I've seen plenty of big subs, big channels sit there watching YouTube videos for hours and talking stupid shit, which they're clearly not allowed to do, playing copyrighted music constantly. Nobody gives a fuck, but if a smaller channel does that, then they get nuked out of existence. Twitch only cares when, you know, when there isn't money on the line. And I'm going to call you out on that, Twitch, because it's bullshit. You should be applying those rules fairly to everybody, and not just to the small channels.
So real quick, just to go back to the acquisitions and the impacts they have, I've been a part of a few acquisitions. I've seen how they go down, especially with sites. A lot of times, and this is why I think that so part of this, I definitely believe that you mentioned AdBlock plays a role in it. I think it plays a role in everybody's revenue here.
It does,
right?
Yep.
And
can I just also say to the people that say, like, adapt or die when it comes to AdBlock, that's a really fucking unfair way of looking at it. Like, there's only so many ways you can adapt to the fact that you are deliberately denying me revenue.
Oh my god, I saw the guy in the comments who was like, just adapt, man, there's other ways. Here's the deal, when we adapt, that's called brand deals, and you guys...
And then you piss on us for it.
Yeah,
we have tried to adapt. Polaris tried to adapt. It was called Sling. You shit on it. You know, people delay their videos for a couple of days and put them behind, like, you know, an early access paywall. You shit on it. Yeah, you know, early access VODs. You shit on it. Sponsorships, brand deals, Patreon, donations, paid subscriptions. People always shit on it. You know, it's, you can't expect something for nothing always. You know, if you're not willing to trade money, you have to trade time. That's nothing is free in this world. You know, how do you adapt to not getting paid? Like, how do I convince someone that ad blocks me to pay me $5 a month in subs? Well, that's pretty fucking hard, you know, and I'm grateful to everyone in my channel that does choose to pay that, you know, but the amount of people that then turn around and say fucking sellouts, the amount of people that shit on me even for delaying this podcast by 48 hours, which I might add is pretty much required for me to reliably get the show up and have it behind this little paywall for 48 hours, the amount of people that shit on me for that is ridiculous. So I'm afraid that there's only so much adaptation you can do, and people are trying their best and trying to do it in a way that doesn't screw people over, you know? Because asking you guys for money is really hard, actually. We don't want to take your money. Mm. I really don't. That's why I try and make my subscription the best value possible. Because I don't like the idea of you just giving me money. You know, I'm thankful that shit like YouTube Red has come along, and I know that Jesse doesn't
like
it.
We'll never have a better value than Jesse. Just let's be
real.
Best
value on Twitch.
Best value on Twitch, yeah.
One time.
Honestly, swear to God, I'm with TB, though. I just don't want, like, coming from a teaching background where, like, you are in charge of young people, and, like, that's a relationship you cannot, like, you don't want to be that motherfucker who's in jail because you, like, tried to screw one of your students. Like, that's, you don't break that code. Like, that's a line you don't cross.
Yeah.
And I, like, it carries over to where, like, the relationship is I give you entertainment and you are like, thanks. And that should be fucking it. Like, that's it.
Once direct revenue support starts coming in, there's expectations that come along with that, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's for the Patreon. It's like, right, okay, well, if we set up a Patreon, then we've got to have reward tiers. That means we need to start producing more content. We need to start using our time on stuff that isn't actually being given to everybody. That's the big problem with it. That's why I don't think I'll ever set up a Patreon, because I don't like this idea that I'm doing certain things for certain tiers of people instead of doing it for everybody, you know? That's why I think that delayed VODs are a decent way of doing things, because everyone gets access to it eventually. You can watch live for free, you can watch on YouTube for free. If you want, it's a convenience fee, is what it is. You know, it's exploiting the convenience and the patience gap. I think that's a fair way to do it. YouTube Red, I fucking love it. YouTube Red's getting better and better for me every month. My income from YouTube Red is now, I think, up to 20% of my total. Yeah, 20% of my total revenue is coming from Red.
You know, honestly, I'm going to tell you why that is. I'm about to blow the lid off shit.
Here we go. He's going to expose
Red, me. No. YouTube Red algorithms, like, changed YouTube. And YouTube now focuses on length.
Yep,
so and it's not length of your video, but it's the longer people watch your shit.
Yes, engagement
time. And the
time.
Reason why you're so goddamn smart is because you're like, here's 25 minutes of me talking, and so people put it on the background, and instead of focusing on a video, which they're like, I can't watch all this, click. They go off and do shit while you're playing in the background talking to them, and they watch all your shit, and it's genius. And I hate you for it.
That's called adapting podcasts to YouTube. I basically
made. Say, Jesse, we need to start. Here's me talking for 25 minutes about Bulma.
Well, I mean, you did that. It was called Welcome to the Fandom. Start doing it again. You'll get more Red revenue.
Just you talking. I'm just gonna do one called like Jesse Reads Online Erotica. And it's gonna be like,
oh, just reading. My ASMR idea. Come on.
Nope. Too late. Yeah. Too late.
Basically, all my shows are secret podcasts. They're podcasts in disguise. That's why I make a bunch of money off RedTube. RedTube. Wow. Okay. I make a bunch of money off RedTube, guys.
Yeah.
I gotta say. It's like,
yeah.
Let's get it on. Let's not. But
the robe helps.
It does. It actually helps a lot. I make a lot more from that. Yeah. The thing is that my format's always been that way. It just happened to be that YouTube came around to my way of thinking
your
like 5 years later.
Yeah.
So Red is fucking awesome for me, and it's getting better every single month. So if you want to know whether or not Red helps people on YouTube, yup.
You know who doesn't help right now? Vloggers, animators, like all those people have really short videos.
Short form, guys.
If you're that YouTube gamer who's like, my videos are 11 minutes long exactly, you got fucked, dude.
Yeah.
Sorry, pal. Yeah.
It's the Terraria formula. As someone pointed out in chat, when are people going to realize this is actually just a talk show with gameplay in the background? It's not actually a Let's Play. So, there you go. But, yeah, it's sad to hear the game trailers going that way. Like I say, they were competition for us a while, but, you know, we've had one of the guys on the show. I've watched their content before. I enjoyed it a lot. I hope they all land on their feet. I really do. And if I were to give advice to any of them, don't agree to anyone that says, hey, come join my company.
Oh,
unless
my God, right.
Be an independent contractor and license out your shows, like Mike was suggesting, for a good fee. Do that and then produce content on YouTube and build your own personal brand. Like, why are you spending time building someone else's brand? Build yours. You know? Yours is the one that matters. Yours is the one that endures. Yours is the one that's going to set you up for life. You set up a good brand and you keep making content, you're set for life. Do it. Just do it.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what happens to YouTube then. You can move on.
Yeah, you can move somewhere else. That's a great thing.
Exactly.
You know? If YouTube dies tomorrow, I can move to Twitch. If Twitch dies tomorrow, I can move to another fucking site. There'll always be something. You know? Because I built my brand, people will follow me. You know? That's what you should do. There's my advice to content creators and to the game trailers guys. Okay, let's move on quickly to Hearthstone news.
What?
Yeah, so I don't know if any of you guys have been paying attention to this. Mike, you may have, certainly. So the huge announcement that actually happened last week for Hearthstone is that they are now going to be doing formats. They're calling it a new way to play, and they're going to split the game into two formats. There's going to be Standard and Wild. Now, Standard is going to be their standard game mode, and that means that you can only use cards from Basic and Classic and expansions that came out in about the last year. So basically, they're phasing out, I believe, Goblins versus Gnomes and Naxxramas. They will not be playable in standard format. Now, as to Wild is just what you get right now. You can play anything. And I believe you can rank up in either of them, and you can progress in either of them. That's my understanding of it. You can... The weird thing about it is that Naxxramas and Goblins vs. Gnomes will no longer be available for purchase, but you can build the stuff with Arcane Dust, including the cards from the adventures which previously required you to buy the adventure. So there's ups and downsides to this whole thing. You know, firstly, you don't have to buy adventures anymore, which are like $25 to get some really good cards. But on the downside, people who invested a lot of time into maybe getting Goblins vs. Gnome cards or whatever, and they're free-to-play players, now your cards will only work in a certain format. They'll only work in one format. Which, to be fair, they only worked in one format anyway, but now there's multiple formats. And some people are worried that Standard will become where people play. So Wild will become a waste of time. So, I mean, I'd love to hear from all of you first on this, and then I'll give my opinions on it. I mean, Mike, you've been playing quite a lot of Hearthstone. You know, what do you reckon to these changes? You know, does this make it better or worse?
So, I've been playing Hearthstone like an old person to play Hearthstone. It's like, I was going to get in and play, like, my Rainhead's Warrior tech, and actually do okay, and then hit a brick wall. So I've not actually... What I've gleaned from this is kind of what you've already recapped here, and that Ben Brodian says that if it sucks, then we'll change it. Like, he's already come out and been like, hey, if it sucks, then we'll change it.
Yeah.
Which obviously is probably the right thing to say whenever you come into something such a game-changing system like this. But, I mean, I don't know. Like, this is something that I would like to, I guess, kind of experience first. Like, yeah. I already just kind of play super casually right now. Like, I used to play a lot, and now it's just kind of like whenever. So, is the standard just the way I just go in just to kind of jump in and play with just what I have? And
I mean, it depends what you have. I mean, if you've got a bunch of Goblins versus Gnome shit, then no, you don't, because you suddenly don't have access to that stuff. On the other side of it, it's difficult because I think like almost everyone's opinion on this is valid, because some people are saying, oh, this fucks over free-to-play players, and then other people are saying, actually, this is better for free-to-play players.
Right.
You know, because you don't need things like Dr. Boom anymore, which is really hard to acquire for a free-to-play guy, you know? Or if you're free-to-play, it's really hard to get the adventures, so you don't need shit like Sludge Belcher and everything that came from adventures and you couldn't craft yourself anymore. So you could make that argument. But on the flip side, if you invested your limited gold into a bunch of cards that you can no longer use, and you have to keep up with the meta by having the latest cards, then that fucks you over. In theory, it could make it easier to get into the game because you have a much smaller card pool to worry about and you can focus better to get a better deck up faster. But on the flip side, if you already own a bunch of cards from the wrong set, then, you know, and once they cycle in the new set, they're going to require you to get more cards from that set as well. So, like, over time, this could screw people over in theory. In theory.
I don't, like, so what was the reasoning behind this? Like, the thought process was...
There's too many cards. It's also really hard to balance them because, you know, power creep becomes a factor. And some of the older cards, instead of balancing them, they're like, well, we'll just phase them out so they're not used anymore. And people are saying you can craft adventure cards. I know that. Could you do it? You can't craft adventure cards without buying the adventure. You've never been able to do that, right?
You have to buy the adventure in order to do that.
Yes. Right. So there's literally no reason why you would ever craft an adventure card, because you just play the adventure to get it free. So why the fuck would you ever do that? But the point with this format is that they're phasing out that adventure, but you don't have to buy the adventure anymore. You'll be able to just craft the cards for dust, which you couldn't do before without buying it.
Yeah. It basically gives them like a public beta, basically. I mean, Wild could give them an opportunity to go through and tune things and get it all perfect and then cycle it into standard.
Yeah, you could only craft golden adventure cards, which, again, you would never fucking do. So, you know, unless, because you'd already have the main cards. I mean, I'm cautiously optimistic for it. I think that it will probably help with some card balance. I mean, who doesn't want to play a game where Dr. Boom isn't played on turn 7, you know? That would be wonderful, actually. I'm sick of seeing Dr. Boom every fucking game. You know, it might shake the meta up a little bit. Might keep things interesting. But then again, this comes from the perspective of someone that owns all the cards. Like, you might think that I kind of get mad. It's like, oh god, I can't use half my cards. I don't give a fuck. Like, I don't care, you know, I've used them, I've got the use out of them, and if I want to use them, I can just play Wild anyway. You know? So, I don't think it's necessarily terrible. But I can see why some people are upset about it. I don't think anyone is wrong on this. I think it's a risk, and potentially it's money grubbing. Because what you can then do is your latest expansion is like, oh, right, well, now you've got to buy the expansion because your cards are going to go out of date and then you can't play standard anymore. I mean, you can. You can use the standard and basic sets forever, but...
I mean, isn't that basically how all CCGs work at
yes,
this point?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. It's how Magic's worked for ages. And yeah. All sorts of other things. I think the reason why people have problems with it is because, in theory, the reason why Magic did it is because you can't change a card that already exists without reissuing it, right?
Right.
So you eventually run into balance problems with power creep and weird shit that is now broken in the meta and you need to get rid of it. So the way that they kind of deal with that is by rotating the sets out. With Hearthstone, you could alter any of those cards immediately just in the code. So really, there's less reason for a format and there's more reason for balancing. And Blizzard's been pretty unwilling to balance cards without some serious problems. And when they do balance them, they usually hit them with the nerf bat so hard they become unusable. Like fucking Warsong right. Commander. You know? Warsong Commander was a problem, so they broke it completely so no one would ever use it again. They didn't fix it, they broke it. Oh.
I mean, there are plenty of people who have said, like, they've never spent a dime on the adventure sets because they play so much Hearthstone they've been able to just use in-game gold that they've acquired.
Yeah, totally. And you can do that. Yeah.
So, I mean, if you play the game a lot, then you don't have to really participate in that. I think that the people who appreciate this idea are more along the camp of, oh, I won't feel so much like I'm falling behind all the time, which is probably a nice feeling for the sort of people who don't really have an inclination to collect cards, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, I think it can be viewed that way. I really do. And I think for newer players, this makes it easier because you're not drowning in a huge pool of cards and trying to figure out what the fuck's going on. You have a more limited pool of cards to work with. That means it's easier to set a goal. It's easier to acquire the stuff that you want. I mean, there is, of course, always a risk that the meta switches in such a way in a certain expansion that all the cards you want are fucking epics or legendaries. Like, right now, it's not true. There's a few, like, must-have legendaries, but a lot of the epics are actually not very good. There's always a risk, though, that they release an expansion where all the epics are really good, so that means that it becomes a lot harder for free-to-play players to build a competitive deck. So that's a balance issue, you know? I'm trying to figure out whether or not you get a full refund on dusting old stuff. I'm trying to... Because that doesn't seem to be on the Blizzard announcement. Maybe
I feel like
he tweeted
would be a
about
nice
it.
Perk.
That would be a nice...
If this card goes out of rotation and isn't
you can
used
dust
in
it
standard
for full.
Anymore, you can dust it.
If you can dust it for full instead of like a quarter, I think that this format is great. If it's just for a quarter, I can understand why people would be fucking upset about that.
It says 50% loss on the dust value.
50%. Okay, that's better than right now, yeah? That's, what's the dust value right now? Fuck it, I'm just loading up Hearthstone on here. I have it in a window anyway. All right, if you hear random Hearthstone music, that's why. Isn't it 25% is dust value right now? Where did you get the 50% stat from?
I'm actually just looking through the comments here, and somebody actually has a huge rant here. He's just kind of going off, and he's saying that it's a money grub, blah, blah, blah.
Right now, it's a quarter. Yeah, right quarter, now it is 25% for dusting. So I can definitely understand why people would not like that. You know, it's it to create Living Roots, which is a common card. It's four. Oh wow, that's actually it's actually 1/8 on commons. I didn't notice that. If you craft a Living Roots, is apparently like costs 40 dust to craft, but the D is for 5, so that's 1/8. What are the other ones? Yeah, it actually I didn't know that. It actually changes based on rarity. So rares. They cost 100 to craft, but DE for 20, so that's a 1/5 ratio. Let's see. Where I'm in Epic. Where's my Epics? Epics 1/4, and I think legendaries are also 1/4. So rares and commons dust for less. But obviously, gold cards dust for more and things like that. So apparently it is the current rate. I think they should up it. I think 50% is fairer. Like if something goes out of rotation, They should at least buff that up a bit. I think 1/8 and 1/5 and 1/4 is maybe not that good. Yeah, I don't know how dusting works because I've never needed to craft anything because of YouTube Red revenue. Thank you.
Boo.
I actually did dust a bunch of shit because I dusted like the 500 copies of shit that I got when I bought 400 packs so that I could build the last two legendaries I needed.
God.
I'm sorry.
That wasn't fun. Click, 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 click.
Yeah. Yeah, I think they should change the dust ratio. If they want to be kind to people, if they want to be reasonable, if they want to be consumer friendly, I think they should up that dust ratio for out of rotation cards. But apparently the core sets will never be rotated out. So the standard will always be there, basic will always be there, and then it's whatever came out in the last year. As I think it could shake the game up quite nicely. I in theory like it, but I can definitely understand why some people would find it. It's going to be on a case-by-case basis. Some people are going to get fucked by this, and some people are going to benefit from it. You know, and it's not based on how much you spent. You know, free-to-play players, between individual free-to-play players, some guys get totally fucked because they focused on goblins versus gnomes, and then other people can do really well because they spent all their gold on grand tournament and shit. You know?
Yeah. I always find it this... I find it interesting. Blizzard tries to walk a fine line between, like, it's gonna, like, it's totally esportsy, but also we're super fun. We're doing it for the funsies.
I hate so, that. Like, I wish they'd go one way or the other.
Right, and the thing is, they do that specifically with Hearthstone and Heroes. Like, that's their thing. Like, we want to be super good at esports, but here's a two-headed character, or we want you guys to be esportsy, but here's goblins and gnomes. It's gonna make everything crazy. And it's like, all right, I get that you want this to be competitive but also fun, but eventually you have to make a choice. Or else we're going to end up in a situation like this where your audience is like, dude, you're trying to rip us off and take our money and, like, fuck us over with shit. Which is, I don't believe that's their intention, but that's, like, it's an easy thing people can say now because that's what it, like, appears to many people to be. Which sucks.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I mean, people are complaining about splitting the player base. They already did that. I mean, you've got standard play ranked, you've got casual play ranked, you have tavern brawls, custom games, and arena.
Arena.
And solo adventures. You already have... The player base is already split six ways from Sunday anyway.
Yeah.
Adding one more format isn't going to change that. And honestly, casual is a shit show anyway. So Wild is probably going to replace casual and probably make casual more playable. You know? Because people are going to have a reason to go play whatever their OP deck is. The question is whether or not... if one of those formats gets so unpopular that matchmaking becomes awful, then I can see the problem there. But right now, that's not really the case. You know, the player base is already split. So, yeah. I mean, if you want a good in-depth analysis of this, go watch Brian Kibler's video on it. You know, he's a Magic the Gathering expert. He knows his shit. He's really good at explaining things. So you can definitely go and ask him. But my overall view on this is cautious optimism. Mm. You know? And it will help people catch up. Because if someone's been playing the game for 5 years and has all the cards, how the hell am I supposed to catch up as a new player? Well, if the format only has the last year... then that's right. A lot less cards that I need. So I think that actually, this benefits new players. It screws over maybe a subset of free-to-play players that focused on one thing in particular. But then again, it's not like Wild isn't going to be played, right? I mean, people are still going to play Wild, surely.
Lots of people are still going to play Wild.
Yeah.
One can hope.
Hopefully. Yeah. So, as I say, I think it has potential. It could go pretty well. If it doesn't, they can just not do it.
Yeah.
Whoa!
It's like, well, we fucked up. Okay, let's go back to how it was.
Mm-hmm. Look, they've been more than willing to admit their fuck-ups in the past. Look at Diablo 3. They like made like, look, we fucked. We fucked hard. But we're going to change some shit.
We fucked hard.
I have no doubt that they will. That if they screw it, they'll go back and fix it. So, just we'll see what happens.
Yep. Cool. All right, is there any more news that people want to talk about? Is there anything that they saw on that list that they're desperately dying to discuss?
Not really. But I'll do a dance for
game
everyone.
Game trailers is like the hottest thing.
Hmm?
The game trailers is just the hottest thing.
Yeah, it was. I mean, it's...
Everything
it's
else is a step down.
Big shock, yeah, big shock. I'm looking through these and it's like, yeah, there's going to be a Titanfall 2. It's like, yeah, we knew that was going to happen.
More brown. Expect more brown.
There might be a lot of brown. There's one thing I would like to briefly touch on, very briefly, before we do releases. So, I'd like to actually give props to Ubisoft. I know, this is very weird. Or more specifically, I suppose, to Massive, the guys that made this. So, The Division, on console, lets you choose between better lighting and better frame rate.
Interesting.
One of the only games on console to actually provide you with that kind of option.
That's great.
I mean, that's like the biggest. That's the biggest thing when you talk about consoles versus PC. It's frame rate, you know. And I mean,
yeah,
granted,
it really is.
You know, high end PC gaming has moved on beyond 60, but still, like when you're playing on a TV with 30 frames per second, it sucks.
It sucks. It, it feels awful.
Terrible.
And there's a very small number of games that allows for this option. The remaster of Last of Us allowed you to pick between better graphics at 30 or not so great graphics at 60. And I've said for years, like, my biggest problem with consoles, my absolute biggest fucking problem, is that I have to play at the frame rate that the developer says I have to play at based on the limitations of that machine, and I can't choose to downgrade the graphics in favor of a higher frame rate on the vast majority of games. Because I'm going to tell you this, if The Division looked like a PS2 game, and it was console exclusive, which thank fuck it isn't, if I could play that at 60, I'd pick the PS2 level graphics. I would, because the console doesn't look as good as the PC anyway. What I care about is playability. Yeah. I don't give
at
a fuck
point, yeah,
how the game looks at that point. I'll sacrifice the looks in a heartbeat for frame rate. All the time. Always. And I'd play way more games on console if I had that option, especially the exclusives. The problem is they won't do that because they want their exclusives to look as good as possible to fool the casual fucks that go and buy it. It's like, oh my god, it's so movie-like! It's so cinematic, said the Order 1886 devs. They did that on purpose to impress casual gamers so that they buy a copy and get suckered into a 5-hour QTE cutscene fest. But it's got a really beautiful lamp! Look at that fucking lamp! So...
A
bit like, actually, the graphics will be the same on consoles and PC. They're not. They are not. Can you play 4K on console? No. Can you put maximum AA on console? No. Then the graphics aren't the fucking same. That's all.
No one actually said that, right? Are you reading for that from somewhere? Nobody actually said that.
Someone actually said that in the chat, and I'm telling them they're an idiot. And rightfully so. They're not the same. You know, people are talking about the downgrade and everything. Like, look, here's the thing. Like, they made a comment about having to downgrade it for console. I don't care why they downgrade it. The fact of the matter is that companies should not be showing the game in a better state before it comes out. Like, the problem is not the downgrade. The problem is lying about it. Like, if you'd never shown us the fancier version at E3 2013 in the first place, we would never have even noticed because The Division's still a good-looking game.
Yeah.
You know? It's still a great-looking game, in fact. Yeah. If you hadn't shown us the lie, then we wouldn't be pissed. We're pissed off at you for lying, not because we don't care why you had to downgrade it. I'm pissed off at you for lying.
I almost feel like Ubisoft at this point, their trailers are so like fake, even to the point of like Alpha 3. This is Bravo 6. Come in. Like there's like characters playing the games. Where I'm just like, I don't trust anything I see. But that
those
cool.
Bullshit things. Although, weirdly enough, like, if you actually play Rainbow Six Siege, it actually plays out a little bit like that, except less socially awkward and more swearing. Like,
people aren't trying so hard.
Yeah.
I don't,
they were trying too
every
hard.
Every time I see that, I don't trust it now, so I'm just like, oh, well, that was cool. I guess I get a kind of core concept of what the game is, but, like, I fundamentally don't, unless it's like, this game's coming to PC, and it's like a PC, like, I'm playing Civilization 6 or whatever crazy shit. I'm like, oh, that's what that game's going to look like. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Other than that, I'm just like, I have a pretty good understanding of what that game will be like. I know it won't be that, but I get it. All right. Yeah.
It's like every E3. It's like, okay, we'll see what it looks like when it comes out.
When they did the Halo, when they showed Halo and they had literally people on
stage playing
the characters. And it's like, you know what? I imagine that could be what that game could be like, but it won't be. But
no.
it looks cool. Yeah.
Role play. They're basically role playing at that point. It's like, stop it. Yeah. Not a fan of that. But I am a fan of options on console. I think that console gamers should get access to this. They should get that choice. It's unfair that they don't. And frankly, as a PC gamer that sometimes wants to play a console exclusive but won't if it's 30 FPS, I want that option too. Let me downgrade it. I'll play it in 720p. I don't give a shit. I'm like 3 meters away from the television. I'll take my glasses off and I can't tell. You know? that's console anti-aliasing. Like, I'm going to show you how you enable AA on console.
No jaggies.
No jaggies anymore because I can't see shit. Let me play it in 720p. Let me get a higher frame rate. Like, there's only a few games that give that option. If more console exclusives gave that option, I wouldn't even give a fuck anymore.
It's true.
I wouldn't even care.
It's true.
Because I don't care about the graphics. I care about the frame rate because frame rate affects gameplay. Graphics don't. You know? All right, cool. Let's do releases because Dodger really wants to get the fuck out of here.
The chat lost it. It like, pull off your glasses. That was it. That was it.
I have built-in anti-aliasing features.
Yep.
I am the master race, after all. By having worse eyesight, somehow. All right, let's do it!
All right, guys. February 9th, a.k.a. today. We have Arslan, the Warriors of Legend.
The what?
Arslan, the Warriors of Legend.
Arslan. Okay.
Aslan?
That's an expensive Aslan. Fucking game.
Aslan.
It is some sort of anime thingy. Like, right? There's not a single screenshot. This looks beautiful, but there's not a single screenshot. I think it's all cutscenes. So I don't know what the hell this is. But it's by Koei Tecmo, so it'll probably be a terrible port.
You know, when I type in Aslan, I get something totally different.
Oh, Aslan. It has a 30 FPS lock in mid-battle cutscenes, but it runs at 60. So actually, apparently the port's not too bad.
Okay.
Yeah, it's apparently a spin-off of Dynasty Warriors, but anime. So, Jesse, you might want to have a look at that.
Yeah, I'm
looking
at it.
It actually looks kind of neat. It's full price, though. But yeah, okay, cool. Next
is Assassin's Creed Chronicles Russia.
Pumping that shit out, are they? Well, that's three 2D Assassin's Creed games in like a year? Jesus, yep. Man. You know, wear a condom. What the fuck?
And the movie's coming.
Yeah.
Can't wait.
Synergy, dog.
Yep. All right, next.
Next is Firewatch, which we talked about earlier.
Super depressing.
Today.
Don't play the intro if you're sad, because it'll make you more sad.
And next up is the preposterous awesomeness of everything.
It is a hilarious satirical point and click, apparently, according to this.
It looks crazy.
That awesome. Seems like a Fan Friday game, man. You need to go check that out.
Game. Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Moving on to February 11th, we have Wayward Terran Frontier Zero Falls.
I like the look of this. It's sort of like a Space Pirates and Zombies or Star. There was a Star something game that was like this. It's a space RPG where you kind of build your ship and it's top down. It actually looks right up my alley. But it is early access, so there you go.
Next up is Dreamcatcher Chronicles Manito.
Manito.
What?
Can I use my special powers?
You can.
Is this a big fish game?
Hold on.
No, I was wrong. It's Viva Media. It's Viva Media, who's the other big fish-like game, though. Because they made House of 1,000 Doors and all of the other fucking games. I was half right. My powers. I still have my powers. They're just not tuned yet. Okay.
Yeah, it's early.
How about this one? Pesadelo Regressao.
That sounds like a pasta sauce. I gotta be honest.
It does. That sounds delicious. I'm in.
The Pesadelo Regressao. The cemetery filled with hostile creatures, a church that will not save you, complex puzzles, and a fragile, intelligent girl with a thirst for revenge. So it's some sort of weird first person. It's got a nice looking lamp. That is a really nice-looking fucking lamp. Is this Unreal Engine 4? It looks like it. That is a beautiful lamp. Next!
Next up, we've got Level 22, Gary's Misadventure.
I'm not going to apologize. I love lamp. What can I say? The Renegades of Orion?
No, Gary's Misadventure.
Okay, sorry, I missed that completely. That is
Level 22, Gary's Misadventure.
There's a terrible name for a game. The first stealth game set in the merciless and frenetic world of work. So apparently it's a stealth game where you work a real job.
It's not a Gary's mod?
Nothing to do with Gary's mod. That does sound awful, but let's see how it turns out. Okay, next.
Next up, on February 12th, we have the Renegades of Orion 2.0.
This hasn't got anything to do with Mars of Orion, does it?
What? The hell is this game?
What the shit is this?
What is this game?
I have no idea. The Black Magicians and the Reptile Creatures, apparently. This was made by Otakumaker.com is the publisher for this.
Perfect. Good.
What the hell? This is when like old Flash animations would like simulate you tripping balls.
I can't even reading the description of this gives me no information at all on what this game is.
During this battle, there was a transfer of consciousness of a fighter who had the most power of cosmic light. He's called Chen.
That doesn't help me at all.
I think it answers all of our questions.
Yeah. Okay, next.
Next is called Defragmented. I feel like we saw this on the list.
Yes, this is the one.
It's a lightning-fast cyberpunk action RPG. There is a droid in a hat, and it's called Delio. It has a top hat on it.
What's the Delio?
Is this a top-down laser shooter?
Yeah, it's a top-down kind of laser RPG kind of thing. Action RPG. But it's all really fast, apparently.
Cool.
Looks procedural loot, destructible environments. I'm in. Sure. Next.
All right, next up is Project Graviton.
This is a puzzle game of some sort.
Yes.
It's a platformer. You control Bob. This looks terrible. Next.
Gravity Bob. Next game is called Doors, and that's it. Just Doors.
I've heard some good things about this. It's a first-person logic game made by one person inspired by Limbo and the Stanley Parable. There's a screenshot here that said, one of these doors leads to bacon, the other leads to death.
Great.
Oh, wow.
It looks kind of neat. Yep. I mean, sure.
Well, next is Mosaic Maze.
That's a generic sounding name. It's a minimalist hardcore precision platformer. Oh, fuck that.
Oh, this is your favorite kind of game.
I love this genre. No. Next.
Great. Next is called Drawed RPG in all caps, Tendri's Tale.
Subtitle. It's a puzzle dungeon crawler similar to desktop dungeons, they claim. Looks like it came out in the Chips Challenge era, honestly. But there you go. Next.
All right. Next is called Recursion Deluxe.
Platformer.
Puzzle yep. A crash landing on a world inhabited by bee-like life forms.
Ooh.
Not the bees!
No. Anything but the bees. This actually looks like it's ripping off Mario's aesthetic in a big way. But there are bees, so it's okay. Next.
Great. Next is called Snack Escape, but with
snake
no
escape.
C.
Yeah.
You mean snake escape?
That's what it's supposed to be. Oh, because it's a snake, but he uses the E in escape. Fuck! All right, got it.
Well done. It's a turn-based logic game turning the traditional snake gameplay concept upside down. You will mantle the role of food running away from the snakes.
Great.
There you go.
Next is called Valley of Death.
I'm sure that's really, really pleasant.
It's an
action survival game. Yep. Well done. Mike's survival sense is tingling. 1,000 hours of space sim has given him the ability to detect survival games in early access from a distance. There you go. Well done.
God. Even the video is in like 15 frames per second. That doesn't help at all.
We're gonna have to do a contest at one point where we get a guy or someone to be the host, and he throws names of games at us, and we have to detect whether or not they're big fish games or early access survival games.
Can I be on there and try to point out anime bullshit games?
Yes.
Great.
Next.
All right. Next is called Nutzel, the Battle of the Bulge.
It's just nuts. It's nuts! Exclamation is the Battle of Bulge.
I was gonna make a perverted joke, but I realized that they're making it already. It is a Decision Games card game that recreates the famous World War II battle in which the German army mounts a surprise attack on the US forces. So it is a card game called Nuts Battle of the Bulge. You can battle my bulge, if you know what I mean. Yep.
Sure.
Yeah.
All right. On February 13th, we have Lost World Zero.
This is a futuristic world survival game. This sounds
Did you detect that, or did you have to go and look at it?
I had this one open. I actually had it saved, because I was like, this is something I'm interested in.
I was going to say, your powers might be greater than mine if you detected that.
So specific. So real.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
All right, next.
Like, interesting.
Yeah, looks good.
It looks kind of interesting.
It's got a very, what the hell's the name of that game that's probably never coming out from Hello, the space game?
No Man's Sky?
No Man's Sky. It has a very No Man's Sky-esque kind of aesthetic. Yes. Next!
Next is called Kindred Spirits on the Roof.
Kindred Spirits.
Anime bullshit.
It's anime bullshit. Next.
Next is called Break Chance Memento.
Is this also anime bullshit?
Maybe.
I hope so.
No, it's a story about family bonds and time travel. It's anime bullshit! Yeah! I have the power! I have the power, too!
All right, February 15th, The Ship Remastered.
Yeah! I can't wait to play that with all of you. You're going to hate me. I love this.
It was so bad.
Oh, man, The Ship is amazing. I can't wait for this. I really hope it's good. We're gonna definitely all have to do a session of The Ship together. It's so good.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Love that game.
Next is Control Craft 2.
It's a fast-paced RTS, apparently, which doesn't look anything like an RTS.
It doesn't look like an RTS, no.
No, it doesn't.
All.
It's like Lemmings?
Huh.
Is it like an Awesome Knots version of what an RTS would be, where it's like on the side, like a 2D instead of like top down?
I have a feeling that this is what people are starting to call RTS now, which is basically the, what the fuck is the name of that game on iOS that really seemed to start this genre, where you basically sent a swarm of ships at a planet and it was numbers versus numbers, and it was basically just that. It was called like a game of the Gra. I mean, I'd say it's like Oil Rush, maybe, which, again, nobody's played, so that's a useless comparison. So, that's unfortunate. Oh, well, never mind. Next.
Next is called Devil Ceiling Stone.
Devil Ceiling Stone. That sounds like an RPG, is it?
Kind of?
It's an action puzzle game, actually. So I was wrong there. There you go.
All right.
Next.
Next is called Zeros, but with an H.
Zeros, yes.
Zeros or whatever.
It's a 3D beat 'em up. Ooh, this looks quite good, actually. It's got a really nice art style to it. Yeah, it's a brawler. I'm in. Sure. Next.
All right. And finally, we have Cube Destroyer.
This is about destroying cubes, isn't it?
You blow up cubes in this game, yep.
This is not a good-looking game. This is
it's a twin stick.
Yeah, we don't have enough of those. Yeah, Galcon is the name of the game I was looking for. Yes, thank you for that. Yeah, it's probably quite like that. Cool, we're about done then. Thank you very much for watching the Cultural Podcast. But before we go, one thing I'd like to say, just as a sort of capstone on the top of our game trailer's obituary, guess who we're bringing on the podcast next week? Mr. Kyle Bossman will be on the show next week.
Yeah.
We have every intention of trying to help those guys land on their feet. And of course, if any of the other Game Trailers guys want to come on the show, we will more than welcome them too. So we will try and help you guys. It sucks. You know, we will hopefully at least give you a couple of extra subs. Cool. Right. Watch what's on our channels. Fony, a.k.a. Mike B, what's coming up over the next couple of weeks?
I just released an album yesterday. Music.
Wow. What is where do I find this album?
How convenient.
It's at akaMikeB.bandcamp.com. You can check
akaMikeB.bandcamp.com if you want to check
it
out.
Is it all reggae? Is it reggae and Fat House
it
jams?
Is like future reggae or something. No, it's
future reggae.
Yeah, reggae? Sure.
It's called Suddenly Human.
It's called Jesse Step. Actually, it's the newest hottest thing.
Oh shit, son!
I like it.
Wow, dog.
Yep, it's $7. You can go buy it on akaMikeB.bandcamp.com. Go check it out there.
Yes.
Dick.
Cool. Jesse, what's coming up?
Yo, it's a week of watches. Overwatch and Firewatch. Brace your butt. It's coming to the channel. That's literally all I'm going to play this week. So
yeah. As soon as I get off this call, I'm going to go play Overwatch. I'm going to be honest.
Get ready.
I want more fat skins. I now have a new reason to play. I want more skins. I want to make JP jealous. Dodger, what's coming up for you?
On the channel, we're still doing Aviary Attorney, and Secrets of Grindea is finally going up on the channel, because I had some problems, getting videos up while I was gone for the last couple of weeks, but, yeah, if you are interested in streamy stuff right after this, my cousin and I are going to marry each other in Final Fantasy XIV, so...
Oh.
That's what we're doing.
That's not weird at all.
It's not.
Are you planning on moving to Texas once you get married to Stribbin? Is that where we're going to go? Or Alabama, perhaps? I make jokes because there is incest there. Oh, God. All right. There's probably not much coming to mind. I've got chemo tomorrow, so fuck chemo, by the way. But maybe I'll get a video done tonight. I'll probably just do an Overwatch video showing you my fat loot, and that'll be it. I'll be uploading the podcast, of course. Is there anything else I'm doing? Do you have any... I was thinking of doing a Crashlands video, but only if I can play a few more hours tonight. But now I really want to play Overwatch, so maybe not. So, yeah, I just watch the stuff I already have. I'll be back to full speed probably on Sunday. Secret Hitler Sunday is back on Sunday at the usual time of 5 p.m. Eastern. So you can come and watch us play Secret Hitler. I know Cry's in for it. Jesse, are you in for it?
Sure, maybe.
Excellent. Dodgy, you're in for it?
Maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe?
Maybe.
She's Hitler. Dude, she's so...
She's obviously Hitler. Clearly Hitler.
She's Hitler.
Clearly Hitler.
Yep, and after that, I want to be back at full speed. I've got so many cool ideas for fucking videos. I'm going to make them, and you're going to watch them, and I'm going to get red revenue. It's going to be awesome.
Yeah!
I'm
going to make them, so you're going to fucking watch them.
All right, I'm going to promise one more thing. I am going to make you a custom tastes video. So I ordered $450 of British snacks.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, God.
I do this about every 6 months. It's most of the cost of the shipping because it weighs a ton. I ordered a bunch of British snacks. Because I was so disappointed by the Universal Yum's British box, I'm going to make my own British box. I'm going to tell you what the best British snacks are, and I'm going to make a video on it. It's going to be fucking great. You're going to find it over.
Make a box called the Total Biscuit Brit Box.
The Brit Box.
Sell it for money.
Yeah. I should, yeah, so YouTube.com/JennaBain. Those snacks are supposed to last me for, like, the next 6 months. There's so many of them. I buy them in bulk. But, yeah, I'm going to make that video for you. And that should be fun.
I like how he admitted that the word supposed to was in that sentence. They're supposed to last me for the next 6 months. Very diplomatic of you.
Mini eggs. Oh, they made these. You see these fucking marvelous mix-ups? It's literally just a bag of random shit. Like, it's got buttons and mini eggs. It's got mini Oreos in it, which actually taste
good.
Yeah, they
this?
Randomly put Oreos in it for no reason. So yeah, I also bought my wife an Easter egg called the Chocolate Extremist, which I thought it's like ISIS that endorses this Easter egg.
That is my new Tumblr name, the yes. Chocolate Extremist.
Brought to you by the Daesh, the ISIS Easter egg.
I am the Chocolate Extremist.
The Chocolate Extremist. All right, we're done. Dodger needs to get the fuck out of here, as do we. Thank you very much for watching the podcast. Big thanks to our sponsor today, Crunchyroll.com/TotalBiscuit. Go there for unlimited anime in 1080p. Free trial. People want to watch me stream Overwatch. I want to eat something, and then maybe I will. I'm not promising a damn thing. Thank you very much for watching, folks. Do go and watch the winner of the Secret Hitler highlight contest. It's over on my channel right now, and I also have a video of me shitting on Punch Club for 30 minutes, so do go and enjoy that. Thank you very much for watching, folks. Our next guest next week at the same time will be Kyle Bossman of the now sadly extinct Gametrailers, so do come and watch us, do come and support us, because he certainly very much deserves that support. We're done. Thanks a lot. Goodbye!